I'll just give you my message up front. Try not to go extinct. That's it.
The moon does exist.
Look at this graph.
Dinosaurs had not died, perhaps in some catastrophe. No reason to think dinosaurs wouldn't still be here, wouldn't still be dominating the Earth.
Tradune. Tradune.
Ontogeny.
Dirter.
Thank you.
Hello. Without a doubt, you came here today to learn about
the most extraordinary group of animals that have ever appeared on this planet, the dinosaurs. But today,
in contrast to those magnificent beasts, the creature we will be examining is admittedly less impressive, even puny in stature at less than 2 meters tall. It is the paleontologist. Normally, it is elusive, but now, using the latest in streaming technology,
we can see for ourselves. Shall we?
Hello there, everybody. And welcome back to Paleontologizing.
Feeding almost entirely on plants, it has no sharp claws or fearsome teeth. Being so preoccupied with the study of ancient life, the fossil scientist seems to exist only to dig up, examine, and discuss fossils. Although many of his kind are shy and retrusive, ours here has learned to communicate over vast distances, broadcasting his strange sounds far and wide.
Ankylosaurus and Triceratops, Tyrannosaurus Rex. It is indeed true, in human face bone, birds are dinosaurs.
His bizarre display is fascinating to watch. Creatures like this are quite rare, requiring very specific conditions to survive.
Thanks for the hydrate. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Pretty cool, right?
So that it does not die out like the fossil organisms which it studies, we must work to protect this rare and curious creature from extinction.
Well, hello, hello, everyone. And welcome back to Paleontologizing. It's really good to see you here. I'm glad you could make it today. Happy Tuesday to you. And I hope you're ready for, some more fossil science right now. Starting off pretty chill today, I guess. Even our music right now, but yeah. We're gonna be trying something slightly off the wall today, or something to do with walls, I suppose. World Architecture Day was on the calendar. Apparently it was yesterday. Although we were celebrating World Vegetarian Day yesterday, talking about herbivorous dinosaurs. So we're celebrating World Architecture Day today. We're talking about architecture and fossil science. Two seemingly very disparate topics. We're going to draw some connections between them in hopefully a way that's going to be kind of interesting. We'll see how non-tenuous we can make that connection, but we'll see. We'll see. Anyway, it's good to have you here, everybody. If If it's your very first time here, then an extra special welcome to you. Let me introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. And I'm here on Twitch trying to do some good old-fashioned science outreach. How does that work? Well, first of all, as a dinosaur paleontologist, probably know already, a paleontologist is a scientist who studies fossils. I work on dinosaur fossils in particular. I study dinosaurs, I publish on them in the scientific literature. I dig up dinosaurs during the summer. I was in Wyoming and Utah this summer, digging up at least 3 new species of dinosaur. Hopefully, wouldn't get them published in the next few years. We'll have to see. But, yeah, I was live streaming that too. This is actually how I make my living, believe it or not. It's through live streams. 5 days a week. Unlike kind of a typical academic job, here I get to be my own boss, make my own schedule, and I can make a living and do my my science outreach at the same time. Get two birds stoned at once. I think that's, well, I don't think that's pretty excellent. I feel it is. I know it is. It's been pretty excellent. Anyway, welcome to Paleontologizing. On these broadcasts, we discuss fossil news. We talk about new publications in paleontology. I do a lot of 3D modeling and 3D printing. We are 3D printing a almost life-size coelacanth right now. Latimeria chelumnae. And, yeah. We discuss different topics, mostly. Kind of the bread and butter of these streams, though, is answering viewer questions. Everybody's got questions about the history of life on Earth, about the creatures that were here before us, about why they're relevant to us in our modern age, what we can learn from Earth's ancient past. What are the lessons that we can glean from the fossil record? That's all stuff that we're talking about here. Natural history, extinction, evolution, and of course, dinosaurs are what I actually publish on. So yeah, anyway, welcome to Paleontologizing. But yeah. And, Stanislav Bender says, hello, interesting discoveries are made out of coprolites. We talked all about coprolites yesterday. I.e. that early humans ate mostly nothing. Do we have coprolites from early humans? I'm surprised to hear that we do. Interesting. Anyway. SP says, here's a viewer question. How many beige tan shirts does Danny own? A few. SP, I have 3 of this particular one. This is military surplus. I got it real cheap. I also wear these shirts in the field. This is kind of a bluish gray, though. It might look different under a different camera. Yeah, bluish gray. This isn't beige or tan. But yeah, yeah. Let me go through chat real quick, and we'll say hello to everybody, and then we'll see if anybody's got any questions that we can dive into before we get to the topic for today. Claire Burr, how are you doing? You may have been first today. How you doing, Claire? Welcome, welcome. Lenina, I hope you're on the mend. Lenina, I heard you're not feeling super well right now. Hope you're doing okay. Hope you're taking care of yourself. Matt M33, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Lenina says, I still feel icky, but I feel much more human today. I'm glad to hear that. I'm glad to hear that. Yeah. Kodali, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome, Kodali. Good to see you. Happy Tuesday. Golganek, what's shaking with you? Yes, I was at the museum this morning, as I am most weeks. Saw some interesting talks. Helped move some fossils around. Yeah, it was a good morning. And now I'm here. What could be better than that? Lenina. Oh, I already said hello to you, Lenina. But there you are again. Scrolling down. Tommy Plotticus. Howdy, howdy. Thalo, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome to you. Lordy, How are you doing? It's good to have you here. Lordy says, so cool. I'll show everybody what Lordy's talking about in just a minute. Good to see you, Lordy. I hope you're having a good day. Rizadegu? Howdy, howdy. Glad you're here. Invisible Dimensions? What's shaking with you? Go for Fluff or Nut? I'm glad you could be here today. Welcome, Fluff. Yeah. Cephalon Wolf? Hello. How are you, Cephalon? Espy? I'm glad you found that amusing. It's good to have you here, Espy. Tea Time Cat? What's shaking? Scrolling. Only Saurus has joined us as well. How are you doing, Only Saurus? Lizard in the City 98. How are you doing? You love connections? I do too, you know? Many insights in science come from realizing that there could be connections between seemingly disparate things, so we're going to be getting into that mindset today. Dr. Irrefutable, how are you doing? Hello, hello. And Lordy says Danny streamlines his dressing process to maximize time for science. This is true, Lordy. This is true. Also, these shirts are cheap, and they're cheap, they're durable. I can also use them in the field. The way that these originated was kind of that, I bought them for field work in the first place from military surplus stores. Because they're cheap and they're durable and they're good under a hot sun. And, it's not... You don't have to say, que lastima, if you have to tear off the sleeves in the field and use them as a substitute for burlap when making a fossil jacket. It's not the end of the world if you have to cut them up or tear them apart or whatever. Or if they are torn asunder in the process of fieldwork. And it turns out these were like all of the collared shirts that I owned when I started teaching. And I wanted to dress up a little bit when I was teaching. And it just kind of became a thing here on stream. And here we are. Reanimated Bits says military surplus is good stuff. Got a belt that has lasted like 10 plus years. Oh yeah. Yeah. I actually just ordered some new shirts over the weekend. It was like $30 for like 9 shirts or something like that. Hopefully they fit. We'll see. Otter Do It, how are you doing? Welcome, welcome. Invisible Dimensions says, Popcorn, important song in the history of electronic music. Is it really? I know I've heard it a bunch of times before. I'm not aware of its history or its importance, though. It's cool. Yeah. And Ennio Morricone stuff. Stanislav. I believe I've also got some Morricone here. Try this on for size. Charlie's Dragon says, after getting into sewing, I paid attention to the details on your shirts, the shape of the pockets, the extra crease on the middle of the front pocket, some of them, etc. See, Charlie's Dragon knows that not all of the shirts that I wear are identical. I have many different shirts. They all might look vaguely similar to one another, but they're distinctly different shirts. Charlie's Dragon, it's cool that you've developed an eye for that. It's funny, when you start studying something in depth and you get really into it, you'll start to notice details that other people miss. It's cool, you're seeing the world in a different way, and I know as a paleontologist, I see the world in a different way from other people. You know, whether I'm looking at modern animals, whether I'm looking at landforms, I'm thinking about the geology. If I'm just thinking about the way that things are and how they came to be, you know? It's a different perspective that you have when you study fossil science. I think that's cool, and that's one of the things I'm here to share with you. Yeah. And, Lordy says, I think I'm going to be making Danny a shirt or two before too long on my stream, too. Lordy, really? Make me some shirts? I would be so into that. Holy cow. If you're going to be sewing them from scratch, Lordy, can I maybe custom design some fabric and have it printed up and then have you use that? some like linen or something like that? Because that would be pretty neat. Yeah. That'd be very cool. Do a crossover stream, Lordy. Or something. I don't know. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. Things were filmed. Yeah, there you go, Charlie's Dragon. That's part of learning about stuff. You become aware of details that might elude other people. That may have eluded you before you'd learn about them. Yeah. So we'll talk about it and do something cool. That sounds good, Lordy. That sounds good. And Lordy, thank you for being enthusiastic about this, too. Here, let me put this link again in the chat. But check this out, everybody. Oh, hang on. Not this. I had to make sure my cameras were synced earlier. There we go. That's better. Check this out. From the Society of Vertebrate Paleontology, of which I'm a member. This is our global scientific society for vertebrate fossil science. They posted this earlier. They said, "We're excited to welcome Danny Anduza to our lineup of guest speakers at the upcoming SVP virtual meeting. You can learn more about the virtual meeting and sign up to attend via the webpage linked below." And there it is. I don't have to sign up because I'm speaking. But there we go. I'm pretty excited about that. So check it out. Check it out. I'm going to be talking about, like they say here, Danny will be presenting on his system for live streaming his dinosaur-centered paleontology fieldwork on Twitch. Twitch, what's that? This will include technical aspects of remote streaming as well as SciComm strategies. This event is part of the 2023 SVP Virtual Conference. And I'm particularly happy about this because unfortunately this year I will not be able to attend the physical Society of Vertebrate Paleontology meeting. And that's because it happens to be the same exact weekend as TwitchCon this year. And I'm going to be at TwitchCon and doing some science communication at TwitchCon. Right here. We talked about this yesterday. I'll talk about it next week when we interview Balint live on stream. Balint of Science Streams. Yeah, we're also going to have Volcano Doc as a panelist. Nerduino. And Moo Hoodles. And Nicotine will be our moderator slash MC. It's going to be a ton of fun. But we're going to be talking about how do you do science on Twitch? How do you do science outreach, science education, science communication? And why is this such a wonderful platform for this kind of thing? It's going to be a ton of fun. So anyway, lots of stuff coming up. I am very excited. And Yeah. Good stuff. Anyway. Lenina says, "I hope these talks spark more science communication here." I'm hoping so, too. Both this, the TwitchCon one, and this one as well. Again, the link is here. If you want to access that and then find this link. Vertpaleo.org. Yeah. I was really excited to be able to do the TwitchCon one. Because I want to kind of legitimize the idea of science live streaming, both from the office and the laboratory and the field, to my colleagues in paleontology. This is a phenomenal avenue for science outreach, for science communication, for reaching out to the public and answering people's questions in real time. It's pretty great. And I would like more of my colleagues to know about that. So this is going to be a really great way to talk about that. And we've got TwitchCon too, so yeah.
This is it. This is the horizon, which marks the extinction of the dinosaurs.
Well, well, well.
Below this level, and out in here, there are dinosaur fossils. Above this level, on these rocks, there are no dinosaur fossils. So I'm actually standing on the level that marks the extinction of the dinosaurs.
Articulate reptile, thank you.
Articulate reptile and the eight raiders have stumbled below that level.
Oh, yeah.
Let's talk dinosaurs.
Let's do it. Articulate Reptile, how was your stream? I hope it was real good. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. What were you working on today? Doing some makers and crafting? Some making and crafters? Were you articulating a reptile today, perchance? I know the feeling. It's great to have you here. Thanks again for bringing your viewers in. And an emu skeleton. Well, assembling a theropod dinosaur skeleton. Very, very cool, articulate reptile. And strictly speaking, an emu, staying true to your name, it is a reptile. A diapsid reptile. Kind of moving from larger to smaller clades. Diapsida, Archosauria, Dinosauria, Theropoda, Maniraptora, Aves, Paleonathes, Emu Dromaeus, I think is the genus and species for the emu. But very cool. That's awesome. Articulate reptile. Emus are some of my favorite extant birds. And they've got very cool skeletons. They get big. Was it an adult emu? Or a subadult or a juvenile? You always gotta ask about ontogeny, you know? Be remiss not to. But yeah, that's gotta be really cool. Oh, Dromaeus Nova Hollandaise. That makes sense, Charlie's Dragon. Thank you. Yeah. Very cool. That's really neat. I love this silhouette of an emu and its underlying skeletal architecture. Very cool. Very cool. Well, articulate reptile, I was just talking about this. I have been asked to give a talk before the Society of Vertebrate Paleontology about paleontology live streaming. So I'm really excited for that. Here's a link. Anyway. Good stuff. Good stuff. Oh, and it's an adult emu. We'll probably have it done and photographed by a week's end. Very cool, articulate reptile. I can't wait to see that. That's awesome. That is awesome. Very cool. Well, on today's stream, we're doing something a little bit different. It was World Architecture Day yesterday. We're going to be talking about architecture and some possibly tenuous connections to fossil science today. As a fossil scientist, I strive to make everything relevant to fossil science, or vice versa. And so we're going to be doing that. Yeah. There is lots of potential for Twitch science streams. Absolutely, articulate reptile. Absolutely. Well, you might ask yourself, what in the world would paleontology, in particular dinosaurs, have to do with architecture? Well, sometimes you get very obvious confluences like this. I've actually done a live stream from here before with Lordy. Lordy, if you're still watching, I'm sure you remember this. But, check it out.
They've been a part of our desert history since the 1960s and a part of Hollywood as well.
Oh, R.I.P.
giant creatures are on
Pee-wee Herman.
What was once a desolate stretch of Interstate 10 just outside Palm Springs. The dinosaurs, a brontosaurus named Dinny, and a 100,000-ton Tyrannosaurus Rex named Rex, could be seen for miles by...
100,000 tons? That sounds a little... sounds a little steep, honestly. Lordy says it was so hot there. I know, right? Let me see if I can find... see if I can find some photos from that. That would have been... August of 2021. Growing up, I was on a big old road trip going across the American West, and Lordy accompanied me for that. And, there we go. They periodically repaint these. But there's me in front of the Cabazon dinosaurs. Dr. Irrefutable says, I think that T-Rex might be a little bigger than life-size. I think you might be right, Dr. Irrefutable. I think you might be right. Yeah. So again, yeah, these are definitely larger than life-size, and there's a lot wrong with these. We could go into all kinds of detail about it, and we could, well, actually this until the cows come home. Or any other bovids until they return. But something tells me that morphological accuracy was not something that they're really striving for here. You know? Yeah. Even if they got a lot of things wrong by current science, they got some right. Well, the forefeet are totally wrong on the sauropod, Charlie's Dragon, and honestly the back feet too. These are mostly wrong, but there's the wrong number of fingers on the Tyrannosaurus. It's got 3 on each hand. That kind of thing. But they're fun. They're fun. And you know, I have to agree with this sentiment. I also happen to love California. Of course, being a proud resident of the beautiful, sunny San Francisco Bay Area, I can appreciate that. Although these are in Southern California, the town of Cabazon. Yeah. Time at the theropod's wrist. They do at least face each other. The palms do face each other in the way that a theropod should. So yeah. Anyway, Gamers Tavern Show says everyone knows T-Rex has had strict business casual dress code and will be wearing a button up. Sure. Anyway, this is a lot of fun visiting there. Went there with Lordy. A while back. Let's start the video over.
They've been a part of our desert history since the 19th.
So these are buildings.
Part of Hollywood as well. The giant creatures are on what was once a desolate stretch of Interstate 10 just outside Palm Springs. The dinosaurs, a brontosaurus named Dinny, and a 100,000-ton Tyrannosaurus Rex named...
Yeah, see how there's, unfortunately, the wrong number of fingers on the Tyrannosaurus? There's 3 digits complete with claws on each hand? Yeah.
Rex could be seen for miles by highway travelers. The creation of the Cabazon dinosaurs began in the 1960s by Claude K. Bell to attract customers.
See, they were buildings.
The creation of the Cabazon dinosaurs began in the 1960s.
Check that out. This is actually such a cool photo. I really like that. But I have been inside this one. There's a gift shop inside, which is... it's pretty cool. It's actually very, very cool. But yeah. Hey, Balint Science Streams. How you doing? Welcome. We're talking about architecture and fossil science today. And what a beautiful marriage of those two concepts here. The Cabazon dinosaurs.
1960s by Claude K. Bell to attract customers to his Wheel Inn Cafe, which opened in 1958. Dinny, the first of the Cabazon dinosaurs,
I'm doing
was
well too, Balint. Yeah.
1964, and created over.
Look at that. So this is the entrance. You walk in through the tail right here, and then those are windows there, where the femur would be, and then here behind the humerus scapula, another window. Those are buildings.
For a span of 11 years, Bell created Dinny out of spare material salvaged by the construction of nearby Interstate 10. About $300,000 of his own money.
I think the original plan was to actually have a dinosaur museum on the inside with an actual sauropod skeleton. Lounge area, exhibition area, fire exit, down to cinema. They're going to have a movie theater inside, too. It didn't really work out that way, as I understand it. Yeah.
The biomorphic building that was to become Denny was first erected as a steel framework over which an expanded metal grid was formed in the shape of a dinosaur. All of it was then covered with coats of spray concrete. Bell was quoted in 1970 as saying the 45-foot-high, 150-foot-long Denny was the first dinosaur in history, so far as he knew, to be used as a building.
That's not true. It's not true. Chat, can you think of another time that a dinosaur in history was used as a building? As far as he knew might be correct. There you go, Diagonal. Yeah. The Crystal Palace dinner? I wasn't even thinking of that one, Claire Burr, but that's another one. Yeah. Oh, there's another one, too. A building used as shelter with a roof. Well, you know, Dr. Javasaurus? Yeah, we'll talk about Bone Cabin later in the stream. Yes. You got it. We will talk about that. But for right now, let's continue this. Go back just a
touch. Dinosaur in history, so far as he knew, to be used as a building. His original vision for Denny included dinosaur eyes that would glow at night and spit fire, predicting it'll, quote, scare the dickens out of a lot of people driving over the pass. Those two features, however, were never added. The dinosaurs were inspired by a childhood visit of Bell's to Atlantic City, where he saw Lucy, a building shaped like an elephant.
That is actually really cool, and I was not super aware of this until this morning when I was looking this up. Maybe we'll look at that in a little bit too, but yeah, this is still there in Atlantic City, New Jersey, which is pretty cool. But yeah.
By a childhood visit of Bell's to Atlantic City, where he saw Lucy, a building shaped like an elephant. Bell came to California when he was hired by Knott's Berry Farm to build statues in the new ghost town. Years later, he also created the huge Minuteman that stands outside Independence Hall in Buena Park. A second dinosaur, Mr. Rex, was constructed near Denny in 1981. Originally, a slide was installed in Rex's tail. It was later filled with concrete, making it unslidable. A third woolly mammoth sculpture and prehistoric garden were drafted, but never completed after Bell died in 1988. Bell's daughter, Wendy Murphy, who lives in Costa Mesa, said, quote, he wanted to build a monument that would withstand the sands of time. And he's certainly done just that.
Pretty cool. Yeah, dinosaurs and architecture. There you have it. And let's take a look at another video here real quick. The Cabazon Dinosaurs.
In this video, we are just west of Palm Springs in Cabazon, California. To a place that the late Hugh Hauser claimed, if there was ever a California roadside attraction, this is it. Of course, I'm talking about the giant dinosaurs, which also features a gift shop and a dinosaur.
This is the inside of this sauropod there. Pretty cool. And there were a bunch of almost like bas relief busts in here of like different proto-human species. And they're actually labeled, if I recall correctly. It's cool stuff. I wish I'd gotten a t-shirt there.
The dinosaurs were the brainchild of Claude Bell, who created a lot of the cement statues that are still visible at Knott's Berry Farm to this day. He opened the Wheel Inn restaurant on this site in 1958. The restaurant was torn down in 2013, but the sign still...
Weird Adults says, are you going to mention the new owners? I mean, I could, and we could be pretty happy about it, because for a brief while, the whole kit and caboodle was owned by a group of bug-eyed creationists, and it has since been resold to some people who don't have
such a like flat earth view of the world. Yeah, and you were just there 2 days ago. Very cool, Muffzilla. Very cool. Anyway, it's back in more sane hands now. Yeah, and get you. Oh, that would be awesome, Muffzilla. Shoot, if you really wanted to, that would be incredible. Holy cow! Size medium. I've got a PO box command there. You took a pic of the shirts. I'd love to see them. I would love to see them. Yeah.
Remains.
Yeah.
The restaurant is famous for being the location of the movie Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Muffzilla, that would be phenomenal. I'd be happy to Venmo you or PayPal you for a shirt. Yeah, absolutely.
Where Pee-wee Herman claims that large...
And that would be great, Claire, if you could send that to me. Yeah, otherwise I'll probably forget. There's a lot going on.
Restaurant, so he had the idea to create large dinosaurs. The one closest to the camera, the Brontosaurus, is named Diney.
Brontosaurus. Yeah, there's a lot that we would change about this nowadays. I mean, it's already too big, which is fine. That's fine. But, yeah, the neck posture, the tail shouldn't be dragging on the ground. There's a lot about this that I would change. But it's pretty cool. And this is not too different from the depiction of dinosaurs that was popular at the time. In the 1950s, 1960s, when did he draw up the plans for that? In fact, that little kind of downturned corner of the mouth there and the kind of wrinkly bit on the neck really reminds me of Rudolf Zallinger's famous Brontosaurus. There we go. Right there. Let's open this in a new tab. There we go. So, here. 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 Do you see the resemblance that I see? I don't think that's entirely coincidental. I think it may have been directly inspired by this very, very influential fresco here. We've talked all about the famous Age of Reptiles mural in the past.
And it's therefore likely that we're here today because...
Oh, Lunisaurus.
By the luck of the draw, dinosaurs who had been dominant over mammals in ordinary times got felled in a mass extinction.
Lunisaurus, thank you for the 11 months. I really appreciate that, Lunisaurus. How are you doing? Thanks for supporting me for the past 11 months. That's almost a whole year. Thank you. For once, it is almost a whole year. But yeah, yeah. Good stuff. Yeah, and Sinclair Dinoland vibe. I think this may have actually predated Sinclair Dinoland, though, because that was 1964. Claude Bell may have come up with the plans for this before Sinclair Dinoland. Yeah. And Wiles Paleo, thank you. Wiles says, good evening. Glad to see that David Leverin got in touch with you about the virtual conference. Yes, indeed. He did, and I can't wait. We were talking about that earlier. Here. Where was that? There we go. Yeah, here again is a link for anybody wondering about that. But yeah. Good stuff. Good stuff. Anyway, shall we return to our paleontology architecture crossover here? And thank you, Dr. Terra. Paleo News. Oh. New extinct rhinoceros. New Tanistrophiid. Terror bird footprints. I did see the terror bird when they hold their second toe up like a Sariema bird. Pretty cool stuff. Thank you, Dr. Terra. Good to have you back. Let's continue.
And construction began on him in 1964.
1964. So Claude Bell drew up the plans for this before Sinclair Dinoland. Sinclair Dinoland also drew inspiration both from the Zallinger mural and from the paintings of Charles R. Knight. Yeah.
And he was completed in 1975.
Wow.
He is 45 feet tall and 150 feet long.
Huh.
He's made with a metal frame.
So, like, this is a little bit bigger than even the biggest of the sauropods. So the very biggest sauropods that ever actually lived would be not quite this big. They'd be... This is also, like, bulkier. They'd be a little bit taller. But not as long. They'd be less massive overall. Yeah, we'll look at, like, Patagotitan. So this dinosaur, not quite as big as Dinny there. But still, very, very large. In fact, you could make a building in the shape of a big titanosaur like this and still have it be pretty impressive. It would just be kind of a tighter squeeze to get inside of that building. You might have to have it standing next to another building, and then you'd... Maybe most of the interior space is in the other building or something like that. Not a whole lot of interior space here. You've got a lot of long, thin bits. The neck and the tail and the limbs. So, yeah. Yeah. Anyway. That sauropod looks sad due to indigestion, having swallowed a whole gift shop. There you go, Beats. Yeah. Stanislav... Stegosaurus? What Stegosaurus? What do you mean? Yeah, we don't have a Stegosaurus here. I'm not sure what you mean.
1964, and he was completed in 1975. He is 45 feet tall and 150 feet long. He is made with a metal frame.
And REM Wolfie, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here.
Spray on concrete. And there is a gift shop inside of him, which we'll go in just a minute. As you can see, there are windows.
Oh, the other image with the Apatosaurus that I showed. You're talking about the Zallinger mural there, Stannis. Yeah, what about the Stegosaurus here? What do you mean? Because in Jurassic Park movie, they were mostly Cretaceous creatures. Stegosaurus is from the Jurassic, yeah. So there are a lot of things that are incorrect about this mural nowadays. A lot of things that are very much out of date, but... Diplodocus, Apatosaurus, Stegosaurus, Allosaurus, they all lived at the same time. They're all from the late Jurassic Morrison Formation of North America, about 145 to about 152 million years ago, give or take. Yeah. So all these critters lived at the same time. However, Apatosaurus and Tyrannosaurus did not live together. So this one and Mr. Rex is the other one. They did not live at the same time. I love the big AC unit up there. We got some windows.
Stairs and a fire escape on the backside of Diney. Though I'm not sure you have to worry too much about a large cement dinosaur catching on fire. When Claude Bell originally designed Diney, however, he did want him to shoot flames out of his mouth, but sadly, that never came to be.
Not sadly. Dinosaurs didn't breathe fire. Well, I'm sure the creationists would have loved that. Holy cow. But yeah, that is a thing in young Earth creationist circles. Fire-breathing dinosaurs. Fire-breathing Parasaurolophus in particular. Yeah. Oh, boy. Yeah. And that Ceratosaurus there just getting toasted. Yeah. Just crazy cuckoo bananas loco for Choco Puffs. This is a Dwayne Gish idea. For whom the Gish Gallop is named, if you know anything about, like, debate and stuff like that. The Gish Gallop is named after Dwayne T. Gish. Anyway, Yeah. Time traveling Ceratosaurus versus flamethrower Parasaurolophus. There you go, Dr. Terry. Yeah. Yeah. This is actually the title of a book that I really badly want to get by paleontologist Phil Center. Unfortunately, this book is very, it's like $100. I have it on the Amazon wish list if anybody is feeling extraordinarily generous. I promise I will we'll do a whole stream on it if somebody wants to get it for me. But yeah. It's oh man. Why is it so rare? I know, right, Claire Burr? Anyway. Maybe I can petition a local library to get it or something. I doubt it, though. Most libraries are getting rid of their books. Stannis says, there is a possibility to meet a creature throwing flames. So, bombardier beetles do not shoot flames. That's a creationist myth. They basically shoot out a liquid out of their butts. It's not flames. We can watch a little video on that if you'd like to see it. But it's basically like a smelly hot liquid that they shoot out of their abdomen. There we go. Here's one from a high-speed cam. There's an ant harassing this beetle. And the beetle's gonna be like, no. This is an ultra-high-speed camera. See? Oh, that ant. Oh, get wrecked. Sorry, ant. She's not happy. Oh, boy. Yeah. Anyway, it's not fire. Naomello, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Anyway. But yeah, card source to buy Danny the Dragon Dino book. Beats International, it'd be really awesome to have. I'd love to have that book. Yeah. And Stannis says, I meant that as an example of hypothetical possibility to evolve burning mix of chemicals. I mean, I suppose, kind of. But the idea that Parasaurolophus's nasal passages, that its hollow crest evolved for breathing flames is, it's very, very far-fetched, you know? So yeah, yeah. I'm only pushing back so hard against this idea because it is a creationist argument like this, you know? It's like, they put zero effort into actually thinking about it at all, and that's why I'm pushing back so hard against it, you know? Yeah. Anyway, it's, yeah. Man, would I love to get this book, though. Yeah. Plot twist, it still makes noise / honks each time it breathes flames. The thing is, if there were some sort of vertebrate animal today that breathed fire, and it had a similar kind of mechanism, structure, or something, then I'd be like, oh, okay, that might make sense. Creatures from the dawn of time. What havoc will they wreak? What lives will they destroy? What depths of panic and terror will they create? Naomello, thank you for the raid, and welcome to Paleontologizing. Have arrived to wreak some sweet, sweet havoc. Thank you for arriving to wreak some sweet, sweet havoc, and welcome to Paleontologizing. How are you doing? It's great to have you here.
Naomello, first of all, how was your stream? I hope it was really, really good. Tell me about it. And hello, hello to the Wandering Daydreamer, Bubble TQ, Earthy Angel, Christie's Laura, Mijoy, Mr. Zachary Phillips, more dinosaur learning indeed, Flame Boomerang. How are you doing? Welcome. Many of you appear to be here for the first time. Let me introduce myself real quick. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. I'm here on Twitch doing some good old-fashioned science outreach. Normally we're talking about new publications in fossil science. We're discussing my work and the work of my colleagues, that kind of thing. Or we're doing live streams from the field. This summer I was doing excavations in Wyoming and Utah and live streaming that. It was a ton of fun. But yeah, here we talk fossil science. If you've got questions about dinosaurs, which are what I actually study, what I dig up, what I publish on, or if you've got questions about natural history, the extinction, evolution, the fossil record, all that good stuff, don't be shy with those questions. Playing a dinosaur game, so we thought we'd come by. Well, you're in the right place, my new friends. It's great to have you here. Naomello, thank you again. We were playing Paleo Pines. How was it? Learning about dinosaurs, so we had to come here. A few people in chat were saying how great you... Oh, well, I am touched. Thank you, Naomello. If you would like to watch someone play Paleo Pines, go check out Naomello there. Thank you for the raid, Nao. Appreciate that. And since we've got so many cool new people here, I figure this is a wonderful chance for us to have a little visit from our friend previously recorded, Danny. An armored giant. Thank you, Wandering Daydreamer, for the follow. On modern man and his puny machines. I appreciate that. Our friend previously recorded Danny is currently sneaking up behind me. He's going to tell you a little bit about who I am, what a paleontologist is doing here on Twitch in the first place, all that good stuff. So without further ado, we'll let him take center stage. Thank you again, Naomello. I appreciate you. And previously recorded Danny, it's your time to shine.
Thanks, present day Danny. You know, people ask me all the time, Danny, how did you first get interested in paleontology? And I've always been interested in fossils from the earliest time I can remember, particularly dinosaurs. My parents like to say that I decided I wanted to become a paleontologist pretty much the moment I realized I couldn't grow up to be a dinosaur. And believe me, I tried.
I was born and raised in the San Francisco Bay Area, which is a lovely place to grow up, except that we haven't got any dinosaur fossils here. So right after high school, I packed up and moved to Montana, one of the best places in the world to find dinosaurs. Just a couple days after I arrived in Montana, I started working at the lab at Museum of the Rockies and the paleontology program founded by Jack Horner. Jack's done a lot of amazing things in his career, but you may know him as the scientific advisor on the movie Jurassic Park.
You consulted on that movie.
I did consult on those movies.
And they said the guy, Alan Grant, was you.
Yes. Yeah, well, fortunately, he didn't get eaten.
But we wanted a credible resource that could back up several theories that we were sort of expounding. And one was that dinosaurs eventually evolved into birds.
And even the word raptor means bird of prey.
And that's something that Jack Horner believes in and could defend, if necessary, and Jack Horner became our credibility.
It was in this program that Jack built that I learned how to be a dinosaur paleontologist and how to think outside the box. I've done work at a number of other museums around the American West, helping to prep fossils, design exhibits, and educate visitors. I did a fair bit of eclectic field work in various places, identifying and collecting early Cretaceous dinosaur tracks on the Idaho border, Sphenodontian fossils in the gravelly range of the Rocky Mountains, Cenozoic fishes in western Nevada. But most of my work out in the field was with Dr. Denver Fowler, who is now curator of the Badlands Dinosaur Museum. In all, I've worked probably a few hundred sites throughout the late Cretaceous of Montana, in the Hell Creek and Judith River formations, digging up dinosaurs. Lots and lots and lots of dinosaurs. And from time to time, that work has even garnered some media attention.
Montana's news leader.
Five paleontologists are excavating what looks to likely be a new species of armored dinosaur.
So we found its head, and we found parts of its armor and plates, and so it should be a new species.
And much like my fieldwork, my research focuses on dinosaurs.
I'm particularly interested in their behavioral functional morphology. All these bizarre anatomical features that certain dinosaurs had, I want to know what they used them for. Right now, I'm working on a study on spinosaurus.
All right, but don't ask me too much about that, because it's still a project in the works, and I can't give away too much just yet till it's published.
But anyway, a couple years ago, I realized that things were definitely headed downhill in Montana. So I packed up and headed back to the West Coast.
And I've become kind of fed up with all the bullshit in academia, so found myself another job.
I am now a teacher in early childhood education. And let me tell you, it's been a natural fit since day one. Now, given that I get to design the curriculum, my students now know more about biology, classification, and the history of life on Earth than most adults do. I've been helping raise a new generation of young scientists. Then, coronavirus hit. In mid-March, when all the schools shut down in San Francisco, I started holding classes over Zoom, and we picked up right where we left off.
One, two, three. I love digging in the dirt with just a pick and brush. Finding fossils is my aim, and so I'm never in a rush, because the treasures that I see are rare and ancient things, like velociraptors' jumps or Archaeopteryx's wings, and all the kids wanna see them lining up at our museum. I am a paleontologist. That's who I am. That's who I am. That's who I am. I am a paleontologist. That's who I am. 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 That's who I am.
I realized that I really enjoy teaching remotely. So back in May, I decided to try streaming on Twitch. And here we are.
This is my passion, and now I get to share it with you. And what could be cooler than that?
I believe that scientists ought to be public servants. Ultimately, it's our job not just to make scientific discoveries, but to teach the public about them. That's exactly what I want to do here. Now, because of COVID-19, this will be my first summer in almost 10 years with no fieldwork. I'm trying to look on the bright side, though. It's not all bad. At least I have more time for outreach, and I've got plenty of cool stuff to work on. And if you could throw some support my way by subscribing, I'd be incredibly grateful.
So anyway, if you are new here, you should be pretty well clued in by now. And I'm glad you're here. I hope you're having a good time. Anyway, let's see what present-day Danny has cooked up for us. All right, present-day Danny, back to you.
Well, thank you very much, previously recorded Danny. And of course, thank you even more to Naomello for that wonderful raid. I really appreciate that. Well, well, well. Shall we get back into what we were talking about today? By the way, thank you, Hegpets, for the 17 months of support. An Inkling for the 14 months of support. Thank you for resubscribing. That's almost a whole year if you combine both those, right? Thank you both. Earnestly, I appreciate it. And thank you, Flame Boomerang, for the follow, too. Appreciate that. Welcome, welcome. Well, today, everybody, we, as I was putting together my, my calendar for this month over the weekend, I realized that
It's World Architecture Day. World Architecture Day was yesterday, but we were actually celebrating World Vegetarian Day yesterday, which was actually Sunday. We're a day behind, but anyway, we're talking about dinosaurs on buildings, dinosaurs that are buildings, dinosaurs in buildings, etc. for World Architecture Day today. And not just dinosaurs, but other fossil critters as well. We're trying to form a connection here between the world of architecture and the world of fossil science. And so we've been talking about these. Dinosaurs that are buildings, says Capavotes. No, not even kidding about that. Not even kidding. Take a look. Yeah. If you've seen the film Pee-wee's Big Adventure, you're familiar with these.
Palm Springs in Cabazon, California.
Yeah.
To a place that the late Hugh Hauser claimed, if there was ever a California...
A Kylosaurus figure. Oh, cool.
This is it. Of course, I'm talking about the giant dinosaurs, which also features a gift shop and a dinosaur walk.
Yeah.
The dinosaurs were the brainchild of Claude Bell, who created a lot of the cement statues that are still visible at Knott's Berry Farm to this day. He opened the Wheel Inn restaurant on this site in 1958. The restaurant was torn down in 2013, but the sign still remains. The restaurant is famous for being the location in the movie Pee-wee's Big Adventure, where Pee-wee Herman claims that Large Marge sent him. Bell wanted to increase traffic to his restaurant.
Interesting.
So he had the idea to create large dinosaurs. The one closest to the camera, the Brontosaurus, is named Diney, and construction began
Diney is actually how they say it, I think.
And he was completed in 1975. Yeah. He is 45 feet tall and 150 feet long.
So a little bit longer than an actual big sauropod, concrete, but yeah.
And there is a gift shop inside of him, which we'll go in just a minute. As you can see, there are windows, stairs, and a fire escape on the backside of Diney. Though I'm not sure you have to worry too much about a large cement dinosaur catching on fire. When Claude Bell originally designed Diney, however, he did want him to shoot flames out of his mouth, but sadly, that never came to be.
Yeah, we got off on a whole tangent about fire-breathing dinosaurs and all this, like, creationist nonsense. But now, here we're back where we were, so let's forge ahead through this video.
You can find a shaded table spot. And in case you were wondering, this Brontosaurus...
Oh, by the way, I did a live stream from this very table in 2021. I don't think I have that hard drive hooked up right now, or I would show you. But Lordy and I did a special live stream from here. I did this great big road trip in 2021. Well, shoot, and 2022. Did a big summer road trip also. And I guess 2023 as well, if you count my fieldwork live streams. The past three summers, I've driven all over the American West, live streaming from different museums, interviewing different paleontologists, trying to bring fossil science to you, the folks at home. And Lordy and I did a special live stream from this table in August of 2021.
You could find a shaded table spot.
Yeah, we had pizza. Exactly, Fall Machine.
This Brontosaurus.
And I will send it to you, Claire. I've been, there's been a lot going on. Five toes. They actually have three. There's like, actually, there's three claws on a sauropod hind foot, so that's incorrect. Yeah.
Right across from this large snake is the entrance to Diney through his tail. At this point,
pretty
I'm going to mention something
cool.
That is going to come up a few times in the video. After Claude Bell died in 1988, in the 1990s...
Check this out. A building that's a dinosaur.
...including the dinosaurs, to a company that is run by a creationist.
I don't think that is true any longer. This is from 3 years ago. I don't think it's still run by creationists, right?
The last time I visited, the glass cases on the sides of the stairs had displays disputing evolution in them.
Oh boy.
Now they're just replaced by dinosaur models.
There
and
we
now
go.
They are entering the gift shop. And when Claude Bell had this place built, he wanted to include something on the evolution of man. So he
there you go.
These busts. They used to be in color.
Very
but
cool.
When the new company took over, they painted them white to try to hide them. As for the rest of the gift shop,
that's pretty funny, actually.
Lots of different dinosaur merchandise to purchase there. The other large dinosaur that is visible from the freeway is Mr. Rex. He was completed in 1986, and he is 65 feet tall.
Holy cow. So about as tall as some of the very tallest of sauropod dinosaurs. There were no theropod dinosaurs, no meat-eating dinosaurs that were this tall. Tyrannosaurus was not nearly this big. But some very, very large dinosaurs, like Brachiosaurus, could get to... Trying to find you a decent Brachiosaurus here. Most of these are going to be garbage. That's not too shabby at all. Yeah, Brachiosaurus altothorax. This is the North American Brachiosaurus species. Yeah. This is a pretty mysterious dinosaur. It's fairly rare. We don't have a complete skeleton of this animal. But there are tantalizing bits and pieces, some of which you do not see here yet, that suggests that this dinosaur could have been well over 50 feet tall. Maybe over the millions of years that these dinosaurs would have existed in North America, maybe some of them reached 65 feet tall. It's hard to say. Speculating at this point. But, yeah. Yeah. And, watch her focus. Thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Oh, and the canters continue. It's the same people, Paleontologist Via? I did not know that. Interesting. Did you get that from Wikipedia? That's interesting, interesting stuff. And how do you measure tall on a dinosaur with a neck like this? There are... Different sauropod researchers disagree how vertical these animals would have held their necks. There's a kind of a loose general consensus nowadays that it would be an angle like you see here. But older depictions of Brachiosaurus show it with the neck, like, totally vertical. Like in, say, Jurassic Park. Yeah, there's the Brachiosaurus outside the Field Museum in Chicago. You can also see one at the, at O'Hare International Airport in Chicago, Illinois, at the, he's wearing a mask on his face, at the United Airlines help desk. My United Airlines flight actually got canceled as I was traveling this summer, and I spent a couple hours sitting underneath this Brachiosaurus trying to find another flight, and, to no avail. I'm never booking with that airline again. I can tell you that. It wasn't actually United, it was Southern Airways Express. And I looked up some reviews online, and it's like, they cancel like half of their flights. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous! And no refund either. I wonder if I can find you that photo of me with that Brachiosaurus. This would have been end of June, beginning of July 2023.
Here's something stranger than science fiction.
Abin and Live, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. There we go. There is the Brachiosaur skeleton. This is right before I got a new phone and my camera lens was all scratched up on it. But yeah, it's a pretty cool thing to have in an airport. Yeah. Pretty awesome. The ceiling is, like, barely tall enough to hold this animal. It's almost as if they created this interesting architectural, you know, corridor here with that raised roof specifically to accommodate the Brachiosaurus. That's not actually how it happened, but this is the only place that it would fit like that. Isn't that neat? Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. Anyway. And Watcher Focuses, thank you so much. I'm a late joiner, but happy to be here. I'm glad you're here. Watcher Focus, welcome, welcome. Yeah. And I'll see you later, Shreyank. Good to have you here. Yeah. So yeah, even the very tallest dinosaurs in real life would be maybe up to about his chin, something like that. These are definitely larger than life here.
You can also go inside of Mr. Rex, but that does require buying a ticket to the location's dinosaur park.
On our visit, which I did not do when I was there.
Degrees, and definitely the most popular attraction was the Waffle-saurus truck that sold ice cream. From Mr. Rex, you follow the wooden fence to Mr. Rex's dinosaur adventure, the location's dinosaur park. Before you enter, there is a dinosaur photo op, and there's a few dinosaurs you can see from the outside. In the park itself, there's an indoor area that has animatronics, and maybe a nod to its creationist past with the saber-toothed tiger associating with dinosaurs.
Yeah.
The area we're looking at now actually used to have
Dig up dinosaurs?
Wow.
GeoGym.
GeoGym 2006 and their seven raiders want to know what it's like.
Welcome, welcome, GeoGym. It is good to have you here. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. How did your stream go? I hope it was really good. How are you, GeoGym? And are you going to GSA in 2 weeks? Because I'm not. Sorry. But, yeah, are you going to be attending the Geological Society of America meeting? The big one? Not the little regional ones, but the big one? Anyway, I'm not doing that. I'm not even going to SVP this year. Although, gonna miss GSA this year? Yeah, I've gotta miss SVP this year too, the Society of Vertebrate Paleontology meeting. Cause TwitchCon is the same weekend. And I'm doing TwitchCon. Out of all 52 weekends in the year, they have to be on the same one. But I'm gonna be giving a talk at the SVP virtual conference the week after that. And here's a link if anybody's interested. Yeah. Take a look. Pretty cool. And he was talking paleo on his stream today. Oh, very cool. What kind of paleontology were you talking about? I'm glad it was a good stream, GeoGym. Tell me about what you were discussing, if you wouldn't mind sharing. You might be tired after your stream, too. If you want to go, that's totally fine. I'm curious about what you were talking about, though. Yeah. On today's stream here, we're talking about... We're trying to draw a connection between fossil science and architecture for World Architecture Day. And so far, we've discussed the Cabazon dinosaurs a little bit. Some vertebrate bones and teeth coming out of some Triassic rocks here in Virginia. Very cool, GeoGym. Very, very cool. Wow. And Paleontologist VA has been working those sites here in Virginia. Very, very cool. That's awesome to hear. Does it look like it's maybe anything new? Anything as yet undescribed? That's exciting stuff. Very cool. Yeah, maybe new. Awesome. Awesome. Lots of teeth. Teeth are good. Teeth can tell you something about what an animal was eating. And thus, what it's doing with its life, you know? Yeah. New stuff is coming out of those rocks, so stay tuned. Awesome. That's really exciting to hear. Yeah. Good stuff. Here, let's continue with this.
Sites fighting dinosaurs in it, but that has been removed and it's all dinosaurs now.
It's funny that the creationist stuff didn't sell, which is kind of heartening in a way.
About 80% of the dinosaurs did not move.
Also, yeah, these are not good dinosaurs. Feathers,
which modern science tells us that a lot of these dinosaurs like did have, though you don't really come to sub-dynamation
animatronic dinosaurs.
They did have several rideable dinosaurs, however.
It's famously a creationist.
Outside on the park's dinosaur walk,
oh, look at those droopy plates.
There were a lot of statues. Easily over 100 dinosaur statues of all sizes. This was the most dinosaur.
Anyway.
Was the cross out in front. There used to be a slide there. Kids could go up into Mr. Rex and slide down his tail, Fred Flintstone style. Though the slide ended up being a little too dangerous, too steep, and so they got rid of it. Heading into Mr. Rex.
Oh, cool. Again, texture, buildings that are dinosaurs.
It feels like you are inside of a dinosaur.
You went down a step. Very cool, Nuclear Cowboy.
After
neat.
After climbing up the stairs, you can see where the entrance to the slide used to be. You have to climb 3 sets of stairs total to get to Mr. Rex's mouth.
Huh.
When you get to the top, you can also see how they make his eyes glow.
Very
and
cool.
Here we are at the mouth, which is definitely big enough to climb into and take a look around.
Really neat.
Or not if you don't want to. Taking a look through the teeth, you can kind of get an idea of the last thing a stegosaurus might have seen as he was some T-Rex's dinner.
No. No, that's completely wrong. Chat, why is that wrong? If this is a time-traveling T-Rex... Yeah, there you go, Aspie. Yes, indeed. What's wrong with that? Different times, very different times. Go for fluff or not. Yes. Indeed. So, Tyrannosaurus is from the end of the Cretaceous period. Let's take a look at our international chronostratigraphic chart. Let's get into that linear time there. There we go. So here's us at the top in the present day, 0 million years ago. And then here in blue is the Mesozoic era, commonly known as the Age of the Dinosaurs. Dinosaurs first evolved probably about here in like the late part of the Middle Triassic. Dinosaurs are small until the Jurassic, then they get big, they take over the world, and they exist, you know, from here all the way up to the end of the Cretaceous and beyond. We still have birds today, which are living dinosaurs. But the big non-avian dinosaurs, like T-Rex, go extinct here 66 million years ago. Stegosaurus, however, is from the late Jurassic. Died out about 145 million years ago. And so, Tyrannosaurus and Stegosaurus would have never met each other. Stegosaurus, again, dies out about 145 million years ago. T-Rex doesn't evolve until like 68 million years ago. There is like 70 million years of time separating them. So some of you have probably seen this tableau before. The Tyrannosaurus and Stegosaurus on the Disneyland Railroad. Just keeping with our California theme, I guess. There is more time separating these two animals than there is separating T-Rex from us. So this diorama would have been more authentic in terms of time if instead you had the T-Rex menacing great moments with Mr. Lincoln. You know? He set the T-Rex loose in the Hall of Presidents. Yeah. And that would be less inaccurate than this. Wild, right? Yeah. Though anyway. Not all the dinosaurs knew each other. This is very true, Ice Allen. The age of dinosaurs is like 170 million years. Dinosaurs first evolved probably... The earliest dinosaurs were probably here in like the end of the Middle Triassic. We don't have dinosaur fossils from quite that early yet. I think the oldest are from the Carnian. Like the Middle Carnian. That part of the lower part of the Upper Triassic. Anyway, but they almost certainly evolved back in the like Ladinian or even Anisian. Probably Ladinian back here. But, yeah. That's a long time. 66 million years ago. To, let's say 237. Let's be conservative. So, 237 minus 66 equals 171 million years. Dinosaurs were around for 171 million years until the KPG extinction event. And we still have dinosaurs around today, too. Birds. But the non-avian dinosaurs, 171 million years, give or take a few. So, yeah. Yeah. And Sy says, that's funny, never thought about it that way. That's the thing, is that so many people never realize that. Because... You know, you're used to getting, like, a pack of assorted dinosaurs like this. Take this one, for instance. You've got dinosaurs like Tyrannosaurus and Stegosaurus. There's a lot of time separating them, holy cow. You've got various sauropods here. This is probably supposed to be Brachiosaurus, which is a contemporary with Stegosaurus. Triceratops is a contemporary with Tyrannosaurus. This is not even a dinosaur. That's Dimetrodon right there. Which is an animal that's much more closely related to you and me than it is to a dinosaur. So yeah. Yeah. Grandma, says Claire Burr. Yeah. Gonna cry Metrodon. There you go, Brannington. Yeah. Yeah. But I feel like this is the way that most people think of dinosaurs. It's like, oh, just empty out the bag of dollar store dinosaurs and they're dinosaurs from the age of dinosaurs. No. The really, really cool thing about the age of dinosaurs is that, you know, holy cow. It's this constantly changing cast of characters. Here are just dinosaurs from Utah. You've got all of these different fauna levels here. So, different kinds of dinosaur from different times. And there are actually no dinosaurs that really, like, make the jump between these. They're constantly evolving and changing all the time. And if you pay really close attention to the geology, you can figure this stuff out. You know? Galara Dragon says, though if buying a $1 baggie of dinosaurs is enough to get a kid interested in learning more, it's worth it. Absolutely. Totally agree, Galara Dragon. Yeah. Yeah. Hopefully, eventually, kiddo will start to learn about this. Really dive into it and learn about the incredible history of dinosaurs here. So yeah, yeah, this is really, really neat. These are all dinosaurs from Utah. And there's only a few of these dinosaurs that have ever been found in other places, like Tyrannosaurus or Alamosaurus. Almost all the rest of these are, for lack of a better term, endemic to Utah. They've only been found in Utah and nowhere else. Although, actually, when you get to the Morrison dinosaurs, almost all the rest of these have been found in other states as well. Except for maybe Eutodon, I think, might only be from Utah so far. And Mimorapelta might only be from Utah so far. Oh, it might be from Wyoming as well. But anyway, every time you see a horizontal line right here, that's like a faunal break. So that means it's like, sometimes you have missing time here, like right there. And then suddenly you've got entirely new dinosaurs. All these ones go extinct. The rest of these migrated in from elsewhere after that extinction event. There's very, very little actual... Mimora pelta may have evolved into Gastonia, these guys, but that might be an exception. All the rest of these are probably migrated over from Europe or something. Big extinction event in North America. Anyway, unemployed Walmart greeter, thank you for the follow and welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. An unemployed Walmart greeter has a greeting for us. They say, Ross from Friends taught me about dinosaurs with... They found the remains of the Mesozoic mastodons. So mastodons are not from the... They're from the Cenozoic. That's already 1,000,000% wrong just in that. They discovered what appeared to be the remains of a Paleozoic amphibian and its jaws. Most of the stuff that Ross says on Friends is just incomprehensible gibberish. And it's disappointing to me because Friends, despite being set in New York, it was filmed in Los Angeles. And you've got several paleontology programs in Los Angeles. If those writers actually knew what they were doing, maybe they'd, consult like a graduate student or even an undergrad about this in paleontology. It's not difficult. It wouldn't be expensive. Be like, hey, you a paleontology student? Can I buy you a beer and just pick your brain about this, put some stuff into the script? It would not have been difficult. Or shoot, just check a book out from the local library or something. So you're not... I don't know. It's aggravating to me as a paleontologist that they get things so badly wrong. It's so badly wrong that it's clear they didn't even try. It's so wrong that it's downright disrespectful. You know? I feel disrespected. So anyway, I'm glad you're here, unemployed Walmart greeter. I'll set you straight. I'll tell you what's what. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Anyway. Stanislav says, during the Friends era, it was not so in to be nerd as was during Big Bang Theory's... Oh, that show, that show is worse. I detest that show. Ugh. Ugh. Something about it just boils my blood. I hate it. We're not going to get into that now, though. Yeah, it's pretty detestable. Anyway. Let's finish this up with the Cabazon dinosaurs, and then we'll continue on.
You can also see how they make his eyes glow. And here we are at the mouth, which is definitely big enough to climb into and take a look around. Or not if you don't want to. Taking a look through the teeth, you can kind of get an idea of the last thing a Stegosaurus might have seen as he was some T-Rex's dinner. That is the 10 freeway with all the cars driving by in the distance.
Not same time as Tyrannosaurus, but we've already established that. Big tangent.
Right outside of Mr. Rex is this giant turtle, which I believe was also created by Claude Bell and is one of the oldest statues at the park.
Huh.
Well, that's our look at the Cabazon dinosaurs.
There we go. Definitely these are really fun.
Want to stop if you're in the area.
So this is the thing, is that I think here on Paleontologizing, we strive to make things scientifically authentic because the more realistic dinosaurs are, the cooler they are, because the thing that makes dinosaurs so cool is that they were real. They're not made-up creatures. They're not, you know, dragons or centaurs or Bigfoots or whatever. They're real creatures. And the more realistic you can make them, the cooler they are, because that authenticity is what makes them interesting. That's what makes them compelling. But that being said, these are still fun, and I still appreciate them, and they're a fun thing to talk about when we're talking about World Architecture Day and trying to shoehorn some fossil science into that. So yeah. Yeah. And they get kids excited. That's important too, Ice Allen. That is very true. So anyway. Speaking of roadside attractions that get kids excited, I actually did another live stream last year. This would have been summer of 2022. Some of you were present for this when I was in Rapid City, South Dakota. And these dinosaurs are not as big as the Cabazon dinosaurs, but perhaps the Cabazon dinosaurs would never have been erected if it were not for this classic roadside icon. How many of you have been here before? It is a special place.
The why question of why Dinosaur Park here is an important question. It's one we get almost every day at the
Field Camp in South Dakota. Very cool geogem.
Was about halfway it's a good place to completed do it. When the Rapid City Chamber came up with the idea of dinosaurs being a part of the park, the Chamber of Commerce was seeing a lot of new travel to the Black Hills because of Mount Rushmore.
Man, Mount Rushmore, what a tourist trap. I went there too. Honestly, the dinosaurs were way cooler, as outdated as they are. Yeah, Mount Rushmore was, I don't know.
And yeah. The idea of spinning off on some of that travel made sense.
Initially, it was during the 30s with the Depression and all that. And
there you go, Bradington. Yeah.
The government was had the work, make work project with the WPA. Grand.
Honestly, it wasn't even that, Bradington. It was just like I felt stupid being there. It felt like a tourist trap. It felt like a trick. Like I got dragged. Like I came all the way here to see that. What? I don't know. It just felt really contrived and boring. I was not impressed by Mount Rushmore at all. I really wasn't. Yeah. I got a bunch of pressed pennies there, so that was really what I was after, I suppose. But yeah, it used to be a beautiful mountain too in its natural state. I'm sure it was, Bradington, and they defaced it. It's just sick vandalism. yeah. Anyway, Roosevelt and Lincoln didn't have slaves. That's why, yeah, those are my two favorite presidents. Oh, wait, no, hang on. Different Roosevelt. That's Teddy Roosevelt on, yeah, he had some positive things going for him, too. But FDR and Lincoln, two of our very few actual decent presidents in the history of the U.S. But yeah,
all over the country, they're trying to find work to pay people.
Felt like vandalism to you too. Yeah, GeoJim. That's the thing, is that those are really, really old rocks. Those rocks are billions of years old, aren't they? And, well, shoot, let's talk about that a little bit. Let's talk about, since GeoJim is here, let's talk about radiometric dating. There's a cool video that I remember about this. Yeah. There we go. Check this out.
It was completed in 1940. The carving of Mount Rushmore was completed in 1941, but the rocks it was carved into were completed quite a bit earlier than that.
Holy cow.
7 billion years ago. How does a geologist...
And those rocks had just sat there undisturbed for 1.7 billion years there in the Black Hills. And then look what happened to them.
Quite a bit earlier.
Yeah.
1.7 billion years ago. How does a geologist know that? And how do they know that the Earth is 4.5 billion years old? The answer is a technique called radiometric dating, which lets us tell the age of certain types of rock. Radiometric dating relies on the fact that certain elements have what are called isotopes. These are versions of the atom with extra neutrons in them. Each radioactive isotope decays at a consistent rate. These measurements give us something called the half-life, or the amount of time it takes for one half of the isotope to decay. When an isotope's half-life is up, half your original element will be gone, transformed into a different isotope.
Anyway, you get the idea.
Half-life and you're down to a quarter of your original amount. A half-life after that and you're down to an eighth, and so on.
The way that I usually describe this is it's kind of like, it's like an hourglass. Where...
Tradoon!
Bimka, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. You take an hourglass, and you turn it over. Think of this as the decay of some of those radioactive isotopes. They're turning from one kind of isotope into another, and it happens at a set rate. If you know the rate at which that happens, then you could take a photo of this... hourglass at any moment, and you'd be able to tell how long it's been since it got turned over. Right? Does that make sense? It's the same thing with radiometric dating. We know the rate at which these things decay, and so we can look at it at any particular moment and go, oh yeah, this rock is this old because it's been going for this long, basically. You know? Yeah. Anyway.
The length of a half-life is different for every isotope. If you wait for enough half-lives to pass, you'll have a hard time detecting any of your original material.
Yep. So sometimes the hourglass just doesn't have enough sand in it for certain kinds of isotope. That's why we can't use carbon-14 to date dinosaur fossils. Because carbon-14 does not last nearly long enough. The half-life is like 50,000 years or something for carbon-14, right? There's not nearly enough sand in that hourglass. It runs out too quick. Oh, 5,700 years, is that right?
That decays quickly.
I thought it was more than that.
You want an isotope that decays very slowly. The term carbon dating refers to dating using carbon-14, which we mentioned earlier. It has a half-life of 5,700 years, and most of it will be gone by about 50,000 years.
Okay.
To date things that are older than that, you want an isotope that decays very slowly. Uranium-238 has a half-life of 4.5 billion years.
Nice.
So it can be used to date things as old as the solar system itself. How do we use this to get the age of something? The unstable radioactive element that you use is called the parent, and the stable, happy isotope you end up with is called the daughter. Dating only works if the only source of the daughter isotope is the decay of the parent. You also need a rock that behaves a bit like a sealed time capsule, preventing
like a zircon
isotopes from leaving and keeping new parent isotopes from wandering in. That way, if you end up with half-daughter and half-parent isotopes, you know that one half-life has gone by, since the rock kept everything locked into the same place. Certain
Pretty
minerals
cool.
form a Tinker toy-like cage around any larger isotopes.
Yep.
This locks everything in place and makes
a zircon, right?
Time capsule. Zircon crystals, for example, can trap atoms of radioactive uranium inside them, as well as its daughter isotope, lead. So, measure the proportion of uranium to lead in a zircon crystal, and you can figure out when it...
Anyway, you get the idea.
Take the place and show that they also match. If radiometric dating weren't reliable, we'd see differences between the results generated by it and those generated by these other methods.
But we don't, they match up.
Radiometric dating is reliable. Which means if we go to Mount Rushmore, we know we can touch rocks that are 1.7 billion years old.
Pretty cool. Before they were vandalized. Anyway, in my opinion, a cooler attraction in and one that's free. Don't gotta pay for parking there. Or deal with the... Well, I was there in the morning, so I didn't really have to deal with crowds. But whatever. Dinosaur Park. Cooler.
This project with WPA was the initiator of that project. And then they just basically initiated a talk with Emmett Sullivan, who is kind of a... He liked himself a lot. He knew he could do it no matter what.
Hmm.
He was given $25,000.
The government asked me, can you build dinosaurs? He says. I replied that I could do anything. It's some real king stuff right there.
And had
sort of.
To get it done.
So I like how he capitalized the word government. Like it's a proper noun.
$25,000. And had 15 months to get it done.
Yeah. So
all that was done in 15 months, believe it or not. And it was open before Mount Rushmore was done.
Hmm. How did dinosaurs get up there?
That construction took place between 1936 and 1938 when Emmett Sullivan...
See you later, GeoJim. Thanks for being here. Appreciate you.
After a little bit of a dispute with the WPA, put the teeth in the T-Rex.
Huh.
Now the construction is very interesting.
Hang on, the T-Rex today does not have teeth. What is this?
After a little bit of a dispute with the WPA, put the teeth in the T-Rex.
Hang on a minute. Did it used to have teeth? Because I feel like it is, it's not very tall dorsoventrally today. Is the head of the T-Rex today only the upper jaw? And did they smooth this part over and get rid of the lower jaw? What's the deal?
Now, the construction is very interesting in that two-inch iron pipe.
I'm getting back into some architecture here. Two-inch iron pipe
is set in each one of the dinosaurs. And that pipe serves as a foundation into the concrete, but also the structure of the dinosaurs.
Huh.
Framing work that he did with the dinosaurs, you know, trawling on the concrete, that was his idea. It wasn't done before at all. He's the one that thought it up and did it. And obviously it worked very well.
Very funny, Holcomb.
After all this time, it's still there.
Welcome back, Holcomb. Ooh.
The enhancements to Dinosaur Park are going to be fantastic for the traveler, the visitor to the park, primarily having a trail that is ADA compliant, that is paved, coming up the hill.
That'd be nice. I'm sure that's expensive.
Of great benefit to
you. That'll be good.
Having areas on the trail where a person can stop, rest, sit on a bench, or go to a picnic area will be also wonderful.
That'll be cool. What are the views like? They're pretty cool.
Get up here. The view is fantastic. It gives you an opportunity for a 360 view of the area. And to the east on a clear day, you can pick out some of the Badlands. To the west, you see a panoramic view of the Black Hills.
I remember going there as a kid a lot because my folks, we lived in Faith and Dupree at the time, and every summer we'd come to Black Hills, and Dinosaur Park was always one of the things we went to. We crawled over them just like every other kid does today. That was 60, 70 years ago.
You know, I've got some very, very fond memories of Dinosaur Park as a child. I have memories of my grandparents bringing me up to the park, and it was always a treat because I can remember getting out of the car and thinking, how fast can I get to the top of that hill? And I can look across to the east here and I can see where they lived. There's something about Dinosaur Park with generational return. We see it every day.
You know, that park has been putting a smile on kids' faces for many, many, many years. And just this last summer, my son and his children came up from Virginia, and I took them up to Dinosaur Park, and they loved it. So I think that's pretty impressive, though, how one little park in that small little town in South Dakota can be so important to people's lives who live all around the United States.
Pretty neat.
To me, it's you know, they've been there for 84 years plus, and kind of have a good view of Rapid City, and people love them, and hopefully they'll stay there for quite a while.
Pretty awesome. Wonderful example of some more dinosaur architecture there. And he said people all across the United States. You know what? Canadians, too. There is a photo that I've seen. Let me see if I can find it real quick. I remember trying before, and I couldn't find it. There's a photo of famed Canadian paleontologist Phil Curry. Phil Curry here. When he was a kid. With his brother, I think? SD, not SF. But, I don't know. He's not really on social media, so... I'm sure I saw it in one of his talks or something like that. But, but I recall that it was, like, him and his brother standing in the frill of this Triceratops there. Like, kind of standing on the base of the horns and then leaning back against the frill. Yeah. And, yeah. Yeah. Here's Phil Curry here.
Well, it's from fairly low in Dinosaur Park formation, so about 74 million years old.
University of Alberta. And that's a different dinosaur park. This is the one in Alberta, not... It's Dinosaur Provincial Park, not Dinosaur Park in Rapid City, South Dakota.
Philip Curry has been at the center of dinosaur discovery and research since he came to Edmonton in the mid-1970s.
First really big dinosaur...
Is that Betsy right there? I went to school with her. That's Betsy Kruk.
I guess, was here I moved out here, and we took out a duck-billed skeleton down on the Milk River.
Since then, studied and discovered dinosaur footprints in the Peace River region, helped found the Royal Terrell Museum in Drumheller.
Anyway, any Canadians in chat right now?
Encyclopedia, and studied feathered dinosaurs as director of the Canada-China Project. Curry's seen a few 70-million-year-old bones.
Well, I worked for the Terrell Museum for 23 years.
The Terrell Museum.
So...
Trail.
In that time, I collected Close a lot of dinosaurs, tens of tons of dinosaurs.
Vancouver. Very cool, Icarny. Well, welcome.
I'll be preparing those for a long time in the future.
Now at age
Jedi Mega Man?
Phil Curry teaches University of Alberta.
Hi, Danny. It's been a while.
Hey, Acrocanthosaurus. Welcome back. It has been a while. How are you doing? Thank you for those 100 bits. Welcome, welcome.
To graduate students, but still gets out there.
He's the first one out there and the last one to come.
Oh, it's Scott Persons.
In the candy store when he's out in the Badlands.
2005 is when I moved to the University of Alberta to become a professor.
There's Betsy. At one point, she was, I think, going to move away from Bozeman, Montana. She went to Montana State University like I did. And I think she was moving away or she was moving in with her boyfriend or something like that. And I was looking for a new apartment, and she had a cool apartment, and so, yeah, I was checking it out, and it didn't end up working out. I didn't get that apartment, but, yeah, small world, small world.
The reason for it was I could stay in Alberta, but do something a little bit different, and it seemed like change is sometimes a good thing to do. So what we have, of course, is a Centrosaurus skull, and this is the one we actually that, have a very old collection of dinosaurs that goes back to 19.
Anyway, the cool thing is Phil Curry was at least partly inspired by Dinosaur Park in Rapid City, South Dakota when he was a kid, and now he's, one of the most well-known dinosaur paleontologists on the planet. So clearly, dinosaur architecture can have a big impact on people. A big impact. Yeah. And Pittsburgh International Airport. Is that the Wonkle Rex or a different Tyrannosaurus, paleontologist VA? Neat. Yeah. And Hugen says, I was listening to a podcast yesterday and they said that hadrosaurs were more likely to have preserved soft tissue. Yeah, it happens a lot with hadrosaurs for whatever reason. I've dug up a couple of specimens of duck-billed dinosaurs from the Judith River Formation in Montana with preserved soft tissue. So, yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's another one. Oh, cool. Paleontologist VA. Cool. Yeah. Anyway. Now, as we continue our discussion of dinosaurs as buildings, I think it would be to show you a few other examples from, like, theme park settings, I guess. Here's a kind of goofy one. It used to be at Disneyland. A very simplified sauropod. Wearing sunglasses for a sunglass shack. At Disney's California Adventure. And this was at least partly inspired by such things as, there you go, the Cabazon dinosaurs like we were talking about. So I've heard this as an example of what's often called California architecture. And, yeah. It was meant to evoke California's programmatic roadside vernacular architecture, which gave California buildings shaped like a giant dog, frog, owl, donut, or other non-traditional building shapes designed by people who weren't trained architects. And this kind of goes into another California architectural tradition here, which I thought would be neat to talk about. Let's talk about this.
It was the mid-20th century. Frank Sinatra was hot, sock hops were very real, and Googie architecture was popping up everywhere. That's right, Googie.
I kind of love this.
You may not recognize the name, but you definitely recognize the design.
Anybody familiar with this?
Funky, futuristic, sometimes gaudy signature style of architecture that erupted all over Los Angeles in the 1940s and 1950s. It can be identified by its cantilever or upswept roofs, neon fixtures, steel overhangs, geometric shapes, and bold color palettes. But just because it took over the City of Angels,
retro future, there you go, Harry, yeah. Forever. Yeah.
And as quickly as it erupted, it disappeared. So, where did Googie come from? It originated...
Dan7237, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. This is going somewhere, I promise. Yeah. You've seen this video. I saw it for the first time today, Mayor Space.
A student of the famous
I'll be right back.
Frank Lloyd Wright was tapped to design a fresh new look for a few coffee shops. The look was unapologetic, to say the least. He drew inspiration from the booming car culture and the post-World War II jet age of the late 1940s. In 1952, architecture critic Douglas Haskell was working on a story about the new coffee shop.
Hang on a minute. Jet age. I don't think commercial jetliners were a thing until at least the 1950s, if not the 1960s. I wouldn't call the late 1940s the jet age, at least not in commercial aviation. sure there had been military jet aircraft like the Gloster Meteor and the various German designs and stuff, but yeah. 1940s, those ages when cars looked like rockets. That wasn't until the 50s. Yeah. Yeah, anyway. Yeah.
Shops popping up around Los Angeles. He saw the Lautner Design coffee shop located in West Hollywood on Sunset Boulevard and Crescent Heights, which was named Googies. Searching for a name for the style of architecture, Haskell thought it was the perfect fit. He described the coffee shop as one that starts off on the level like any other building, but suddenly it breaks for the sky. The bright red roof of cellular steel decking suddenly tilts upward.
So I bet anybody who's actually trained in architecture, they might scoff at this kind of thing and be like, oh, this is, you know, this is just kitsch. This is, you know, not to be taken seriously. This is, oh, this is gross. But I don't know. I find it interesting and fun. And maybe that's because I have a dog's brain. I also think buildings that are shaped like dinosaurs are fun and cool. Because they are. But, I don't know. I think it embodies a kind of almost like optimism about the future and a, I don't know. There's something lighthearted and positive about it that really speaks to me. Yeah.
And the whole building goes up.
The dog is brain bag. Sorry, Mayor Space.
But it wasn't a beaming article that he was writing. The article Haskell wrote for House and Home magazine in 1952 was a scathing one, commenting on the architectural style during the Cold War, saying, "It's too bad our taste is so horrible."
No, it's not. It's just not boring, or I don't know. I personally think this is cool.
But it's pretty good to have men free. The name stuck, but while Haskell found the style crass, others found the style enticing, and if anything, traffic stopping. During this time, driving became the main mode of transportation.
Oh boy. So this is actually the beginning of a dark time in American history. Car culture has ruined this country, but I'm not going to rant about that now.
California. It was a benchmark of financial success. And as more families bought their fancy new cars, business owners recognized that people whizzing by would miss their shops if they didn't do something to stand out. In this case, form followed function, and that function was getting people into their businesses. And Googie was the way to do that. Googie captured the feeling of the future, and whether you loved it or not, it was hard to ignore Googie, and pretty soon, restaurants, hotels, car washes, and amusement parks were adopting the style. So what are the traits of Googie architecture? For one, it's built on exactly.
This is like Lard Lad donuts in The Simpsons, you know? That must be a direct reference to this in a way.
It took on bold geometric shapes to grab attention. Cantilevered roofs, like the first ever McDonald's, used a 30-foot high version of its infamous golden arches to hold up the roof. Angled upswept roofs, like that of Union 76 gas station, started popping up too.
Not fantastic word choice.
Odd, funky geometric shapes. Five Points Car Wash used a row of tall pylons, while other establishments used starbursts, boomerangs, and other erratic shapes jutting out from the buildings. They used these shapes to create alluring signage sure to stop any car.
Sure to stop any car? No. Again, like, not carefully worded, the writing in this. But this design style actually reminds me of place that I've stayed before, directly related to dinosaurs, of course, because it always comes back to dinosaurs on this channel, doesn't it? The Dinosaur Inn in Vernal, Utah. This, I think, is an example of this. This sign might actually date back to the 50s or 60s. There you go. Shoot. Yeah. This is very 60s right here. Take a look at that. I've stayed at this motel, and it's a good one. I would definitely stay there again. If I were ever lucky enough to do that. It's a little bit pricier than some of the other places in Vernal. But, Yeah. And Bronco160, thank you for the follow. Welcome, welcome. It's good to have you here. Yeah. Anyway. Good stuff. I really like the dinosaur motel. Yeah, look at that. Very 50s or 60s. Vernal, Utah. So anyway, yeah.
Driving down the highway. But while the geometric shapes provided a solid foundation, it was the materials and color palettes that cemented the style as one to remember. Neon signs, steel fixtures, and glass panels were complemented by strong reds, yellows, blues, and greens that came together across Los Angeles. But
yep.
It didn't stop there. Googie was adapted by the 1964 New York World's Fair, the Space Needle in Seattle.
I was just at the Space Needle in Seattle last weekend. Well, well, well. I'll find you a photo as proof. You know, pics or it didn't happen. There we go. Yeah. This is last weekend. Ah! Yeah. I didn't realize that the Space Needle is an example of this. I don't know, you wouldn't call it a school of architecture, but you could call it a time or a, maybe less charitably, a pastiche? Something like that, yeah, yeah.
Disneyland's Tomorrowland, the Las Vegas welcome sign.
Oh boy, and I will be seeing this in like 3 weeks when I go to Vegas for TwitchCon. Very excited. About that. Yeah, a motif. That's a good way to put it, Jody Fish. Thank you. That's a more neutral way to put that. Very nice. Yeah. And Katie Wiggins says, hey, Danny, I just want to let you know that my teenage son and I have been enjoying lurking on your channel for the past few weeks. Well, thank you, Katie Wiggins and son. It is good to have you here. I'm glad you've been enjoying. Thanks for your views. And, yeah, thanks for being part of this community, even if you are a little quiet. We appreciate quiet chatters, too. Thanks for being here. Good stuff. Yeah. Yeah, once again, I will be at TwitchCon. For those of you who don't yet know, there's the link right there. So I'll be seeing this sign firsthand before I, help host a panel discussion about doing science on Twitch at TwitchCon Las Vegas. This will be Sunday, October 22nd at 3:30 p.m. It's going to be super cool. I'll give you a link before that airs, hopefully, so you can watch it live, even if you're not there. Yeah.
And the inspiration behind the look and feel of the classic animation, The Jetsons.
Yeah, I don't want to get DMCA'd.
The future to everyone. It brought that spirit of the modern age to their daily lives. According to Hess, Googie was a...
And SV Harkin, I will stay COVID safe. I'm bringing some masks, and I just got a COVID booster on Friday. So I should be at... That'll help. That'll help.
...realization of the future, rather than a sign of what was to come years down the line. People could grab a burger and wash their car and feel like they were living in the future. It caught on fire in the culture and lasted for a good 25 years or so. Googie remained an architectural staple for much of the 1950s and 1960s. But by the 1970s, Googie started to disappear as architecture made way for earth tones, textures, low lighting, and shapes that blended architecture into its surroundings. Hess continued.
So things got boring and gross.
The interest in the future, the gee-whiz factors about plastics and nuclear power and spaceflight, travel to the moon, all of these things that had been new and exciting in the 1950s had become more mundane. We landed on the moon in 1969, and then it was over. In the late 1960s...
Oh man, I could talk for several whole streams about the impact of the space race on sciences, including the science of paleontology. But we're not going to go off on a big, big tangent about that right now. But yeah, holy cow. We are still feeling the reverberations of this to this very day. The way that science is funded here in the United States and the way that scientists think about public outreach, a lot of this comes from the 1950s and 1960s, from the space race. And anyway, another time we'll talk about that. In fact, actually, maybe we'll put that on the calendar? Sputnik 1. That was October. I already donated. Close. October 4th, 1957. Holy cow, Chet, that's tomorrow. Maybe we'll talk about this tomorrow. Do we have anything on the calendar yet for tomorrow? We do. We're going to be talking about dinosaurs from Lesotho. It's actually going to be pretty short. Yeah. Let's see. Sputnik and science plus Lesotho's dinosaurs on Lesotho Independence Day. We'll talk about that tomorrow. Excellent. Yeah. So tune in tomorrow if you want to hear some discussion of Sputnik 1, the space race, and what in the world that might have to do with science funding and paleontology. Tune in tomorrow for that. Yeah. And your birthday is tomorrow. Well, happy early birthday, Mofzilla. Very exciting. Yeah. The silver pumpkin. Yeah, the old silver pumpkin. Beep. 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 That's the sound it makes. We'll talk about it tomorrow, Jody Fish. That'll be fun. That'll be fun. Anyway, I told you this video was going somewhere.
In 1969, and then it was over. In the late 1960s, Disneyland completely overhauled Tomorrowland, and McDonald's eventually abandoned Googie for brick buildings with low roofs. Even Googie's, the original coffee shop that started it all, was demolished in the 90s to make room for a mini.
Oh no, it's a CVS now? Or this multiplexed, ugh, ugh. If there's like one thing that I really, really detest about like modern American society and I don't know. I feel very strongly about this, even though maybe it doesn't warrant it that much, but I really, really viscerally hate CVS, Walgreens, Rite Aid, Long's Drugs, these other places like this. Strode's too are also a menace, Harry. I agree. But I don't, there's just something like just soul destroying about the like pharmacy slash convenience store where everything is overpriced and all the people working there are miserable, and it's like, you know, actually there might even be a clip about this.
And you know, I
not from The Simpsons for once. Oh man, I found this fast. Yeah. If any of you have not seen Oh Hello with Gil and George, holy cow, are you in for a treat? This is not their official show. This is just like a discussion they had with this guy. Some of you probably know this guy already. But Yeah.
I think that we occupy a place in the hearts of theater fans, and we occupy Wall Street. And
we occupy Walgreens.
We occupy
Walgreens. I was part of the Occupy Walgreens movement. They hated the 1%, you know. I love whole milk. And
so these are two comedians. You might know them already. But they've got these characters that they play on stage, and it's you might know people like this. It's almost like they're playing a kind of like archetype. But it's like, I don't know, it's once very specific and very nebulous at the same time. It's really funny. I just can't stop laughing. But yeah.
And then we moved on to the Rite Aid.
Rite Aid. What's your favorite aisle at Rite Aid? Because we've got about 5 minutes on it.
I mean, I'll take a look probably through the soap aisle.
Oh,
nice, wonderful.
I'll look for some Burt's Bees.
Oh, you like a Burt's Bees?
I like a Burt's Bees lip balm.
Yeah.
Burt's Bees is good because you got to keep using it because it dries out your lips.
Yeah.
It's good.
That's
when I always pick up a Burt's Bees when I go to get my
spitting
prescription.
Facts.
You do. You know?
Yeah, they have a waiting area too if it's not ready, where you can sit next to someone's dying abuela.
I like that.
Wait for your vet.
That just sums up, I think, why I find places like Rite Aid and CVS and Walgreens, and like they're all the same. It's just like it's hard to keep track of which ones have merged with which other ones and which are still separate, whatever. But it's just like here in the United States, so much of healthcare, which should be something that's taken care of by society at large, you know, by like in a civilized country, that would be something that's provided for the people. By their tax money. Here in the U.S., we pay a bunch of taxes and then we still have to pay half our income for, you know, private health insurance. And you have to sit next to somebody's dying abuela at Rite Aid. Because, like, all of this stuff is just outsourced to for-profit companies and it's just a nightmare.
Someone's dying abuela.
I like that.
Wait for your Valtrex, the gene.
You know what I love? I go to Rite Aid.
It's like, no, it's nice. There's like four chairs and a heart blood pressure thing that nobody wants.
I like to go, you know, the balls that they have in big, you know, fenced in areas?
Yes.
So light you can't even throw them.
Yeah. You know how children still like colored balls,
yes.
But of course they don't?
Yeah. I like to go to one of the two aisles exclusively selling Werther guns.
I like to confront people with a Rite Aid rewards card on their keychain.
Yeah.
You keep it on your keychain.
Yeah.
It would be cooler to just lose the money.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Anyway, if you would like more of this, I'll give you a link. We're going to get back to our video, though. Yeah, their socks are very noticeable. It's part of the whole thing there, Afro Bennett girl. Yeah, you know. There we go. So unfortunately, the original Googie's coffee shop for which this, like, architectural style motif is named after, it's been replaced by. Ugh. CVS. Ugh.
Not only was the design style not worth building any more of, but designers couldn't understand why any would even be maintained. In 1986, famed Googie designer Eldon David was quoted by the Los Angeles Times. "I can't see why they'd try to preserve any of them. We were just designing them to sell hamburgers." In the minds of designers, their work was done, and could be easily continued by the work of well-done billboards and advertisements, rather than lengthy, expensive, and gauche construction. But despite the ever-changing architecture that surrounds us every day, if you drive through Los Angeles, you can still see and recognize Googie-inspired buildings. You may not have known its name, but you definitely know its shape and form.
There you go.
Thank you for watching. Please be sure...
Cool video there. Yeah, CVS is the worst. I agree, Afro-Bennett girl. Yeah, yeah. Better than the ones here, which are Palin boxes. That sounds terrible. Oh, plain boxes. Alaska. Oh, fellaheen, yeah. But yeah, so the reason I brought that up in the first place is that Googie architecture and dinosaurs often, if we're talking about dinosaurs in architecture, it's often kind of through that architectural motif that dinosaurs find their way into buildings. And so sometimes they've got organic shapes. Sometimes, well, I don't know. The video did a pretty good job of explaining what it is. But sometimes there are outsized objects, like this Randy's Donuts there. Sometimes it's a dinosaur, as is the case with Dinosaur Gertie's Ice Cream of Extinction, which is an ice cream shop you can go to in Florida. This is at Disney World, I think. But it's literally an ice cream shop inside of a dinosaur again. See why this is relevant? We're building connections here. We're finding these things, you know? Video on this? Programmatic architecture. Let's take a look at this.
It's a style called programmatic architecture. And today we're going to talk about where it came from, why it exists, and why you can find it in very specific parts of theme parks.
And why it's relevant to dinosaurs, too.
It was just coined a little over 40 years ago by historian David Gebhard. The general definition is that it's architecture that, quote, uses the mimetic sculptural form of the structure to communicate its contents. So taken literally, a big hat with a hat store inside, or a big cone that sells cones, or a giant dinosaur that sells ice cream.
Well, what? Well, okay.
Okay, so that last one doesn't really work in the literal sense, which is why it might be more fitting to call it by its other common name, novelty architecture. While the name is new, the style itself dates back hundreds of years to a 17th century park in Italy called the Secret Grove of Bomarzo. It was owned by a Count Orsini, who sounds like a magician, but was really just a rich patron of the arts. The garden has these large stone sculptures of dragons and elephants and sirens, but most importantly, a giant head that doubled as a dining pavilion.
Oh, very interesting.
But most
we'll be talking about another famous dining pavilion, albeit a temporary one, that nonetheless rings through the ages. We'll be talking about that in a minute.
Importantly, a giant head that doubled as a dining pavilion. The following century saw another prominent example with a giant pineapple that sat atop the Dunmore House in Scotland. As the story goes, it was common for sailors returning from long passages to set a pineapple on a gatepost to signal their return. Pineapples were rare and expensive, and they served as proof that they were coming from afar. In 1776, the owner of the Dunmore House, John Murray, was returning from America. He was the governor of the colony of Virginia for Great Britain. But as it turned out, in 1775, the colonies decided to start, let's just say, phasing out British rule. So Murray, preferring to stay alive, which I can't blame him for, returned home, and in an interesting turn, decided to place the biggest pineapple he could on top of his house. In other words, early programmatic architecture
that's pretty neat, actually.
Wealthy flourishes and eccentricities.
Huh.
They didn't really serve a purpose beyond being creative and showing off how much money somebody had. That would change by the end of the 1800s, however. Many experts claim that the
SpongeBob SquarePants, living in a pineapple, Harry.
Architecture's new era, specifically in the United States, occurred in 1881, when a man by the name of James Lafferty built a giant elephant house in Margate, New Jersey.
That's actually really cool. again, you can accuse me of having a dog's brain, and you might well be true. That might be correct. Your accusations could be true there, but I think this is really neat. And you've been there often. A very cool role in Elliot. Yeah. I don't know. Something about this makes my heart smile.
The elephant would be named Lucy. I actually have a whole other video about Lucy if you'd like to learn more, but the short take is that Lucy was built by Lafferty in order to lure over tourists from Atlantic City and to act as a viewing platform for all of the surrounding real estate he was trying to sell. It was novelty architecture directly tied to a business venture.
So again, it's not directly from the goodness of someone's heart. It's like he's trying to sell you something. Welcome to America, I guess. Everything's like that here. You know, one nation under the almighty dollar. But the elephant is cool. I like the elephant.
Of course, it was still weird and eccentric, but it finally had a purpose. Novelty architecture.
Hang on. Something could be weird and eccentric just for being weird and eccentric, and you can appreciate it on that level. It doesn't have to be a billboard for bilking people out of their cash, you know? It could just be something cool for its own sake. At least it finally had a purpose. What kind of take is that? Sociopathogen, appropriately enough, says, Danny, if it doesn't make money, it has no purpose, obviously. I appreciate you, sociopathogen. Yeah. Yeah.
Of course, it was still weird and eccentric, but it finally had a purpose. Novelty architecture began to grow in the United States, but it would be the 1920s and 30s when it would really start to hit its stride. And it was thanks to two shifts in American culture that happened at the same time. During the 1920s, American car ownership more than tripled, from 6.7 million cars to 23 million cars.
Jeez.
And a lot of those new automobile owners were part of the middle class as cars grew more affordable. At the same time, the 1920s was the decade in which America finally began to more widely adopt the concept of a five-day work week.
Yeah, and shoot, you can thank union agitation for that, honestly. Yeah.
Together, this meant that more and more Americans had free time to kill on the weekends, and more Americans had the means to travel to do so.
Yep.
The result was a new demand for amusements and attractions out on the open road. It also meant appealing to a new kind of consumer. These businesses no longer had to worry about winning over the attention of a pedestrian walking down the block, but instead a motorist driving along a road. That meant designing...
Actually, speaking of that mayor space, there is a train car diner in San Francisco. I wonder if I can find it real quick. It's right there on the Embarcadero. Oh, shoot, there's several, actually. This is right by, I think, Powell Street BART. Cable Care Coffee. Rail Car Diner. But there's one on the Embarcadero. Both of my parents used to work in San Francisco, not too far from here, and I think they... Is that one of them? Pier 23? I don't know if I'm going to be able to find it. But anyway, that's very much still a thing. Yeah. So yeah, yeah. Anyway. And cars are not that affordable today, says Dan, the BC man. They're getting more expensive. I mean, shoot, there's been a lot of inflation lately. Yeah. They're also a lot harder to fix nowadays. And Jody Fish, my condolences on the loss of Senator Feinstein. Maybe we'll actually have a senator who does her job now. You know? I don't know. We effectively only had one senator for a while because she kept missing votes and stuff, and it's like, this is the most populous state in the union, and we have one senator? That means that I, as a Californian, my vote counts for like 1/40th that of somebody from Wyoming, for instance? I don't know. Don't get me started.
The wall of a dirter. A dirter is one of those things you get at the end of the paper towels, the cardboard thing in the middle, you go dirt, dirt, dirt. Well, that's what this thing is like.
It's been Evelyn Rose. Thank you for the 9 months of support. I appreciate that tremendously. I really, really do. Thank you, Evelyn Rose. Holy cow. Thanks for keeping me here on the air. Appreciate that. Yeah. Anyway. Danny about to pop off. Yeah. People need to realize that elective representatives work for us. This is the United States. We do not have a king or a queen. We do not bow down to some sort of royalty. That's not the way it should be. Those people are supposed to work for us, not the other way around. So, you know, my condolences to the family of Senator Feinstein. But honestly, she should have retired 20 years ago. Lived out the rest of her days, you know, in comfort and let somebody, I don't know, the way that she talked to those kids who are concerned about climate change, and she's like, you don't know what you're talking about. I've been doing this for a long time. Like, take a hike, is what she told them, basically. Oh, man. Don't get me started.
Buildings that were big and bold and eye-catching, even if it bordered on silly and novel. Los Angeles, for some reason, became one of the leading areas of programmatic architecture. Some suggest
for some reason
Hollywood and the locals' embrace of the fantastic, and others theorize that it was just the abundance of set designers in the city. Some even suggest
so those
that
are
because
contributing
LA
factors
was more spread out and relatively younger than cities on the East Coast, they had space to play around with the concepts. Regardless of the reason, places like the Brown Derby restaurant on Wilshire Boulevard and the Darkroom Camera Shop, also on Wilshire, began to spring up. Donuts, pianos, frogs.
That's super cool. I need to send this to iOS. That's really awesome, actually. Wow. I like that. Yeah. And Stannis says, do you know the word ministry? Minister is from the word for helper or servant. That does kind of make sense. Yeah. Wow, this is very cool. Let's just send this to iOS.
Pigs, even shoes found a home in Southern California. Huh. It became so prominent there that the style eventually picked up another name, California Crazy.
Yeah.
Ultimately, that's one of the bigger reasons why you can find programmatic architecture in certain theme parks today. Gertie at Hollywood Studios, the Dark Room at both Disney World and Universal Studios, and Universal's Brown Derby all call back to an era in California's history that their parks are trying to mimic. Even places like the Cozy Cone in DCA's Radiator Springs, while fictional, still aims to capture that roadside atmosphere of a bygone era. Of course, beyond that, the resorts have embraced the same benefits that the original architecture offered 100 years ago. And so you can also find more original uses of the style at some resorts and parks. Over the years, the concept spread to roadside attractions across the country. But as the nation's interstate highway system started to take form, getting from A to B with as few stops as possible became easier. And as a result, these roadside attractions fell on hard times. On top of that, like pretty much all architectural styles, it eventually fell out of favor with people. Of course, it didn't disappear completely, but its time in the spotlight had come to a close. Programmatic architecture is interesting, because while it wasn't born here in America, it eventually became embraced by the US to the point that it's often seen as a distinctly American style. It became a part of early Hollywood's DNA. So much so that when theme parks decided to eventually mimic the era, they couldn't help but include the buildings themselves. I guess in a way, making them part of the park's DNA as well.
Cool. Very cool. I'll give you a link to that video. But yeah, I actually haven't heard that term before, programmatic architecture. I've heard of California crazy architecture. I've heard of kitsch architecture or was the other term. That's slipping my mind right now. But, things like this right here, Dinosaur Gertie's ice cream, are good examples of this. Yeah, and just like Claude Bell's dinosaurs. Oh shoot, she actually, there's like steam or smoke coming out of her nostrils. That's cool. But yeah, her eyes glow at night, which is really cool. Anyway. Yeah. And no, it's not brutalism, Dark Bach Rises. That's different. Novelty architecture. That was it, Mayor Space. Thank you. Yeah. And there you go, Golganek. Yeah. Shoot. I know what you mean. Anyhow. Done with those. Oh, done with that too. Lovely. Now, before we get into an example of a dinosaur, not a building being made to look like a dinosaur, but dinosaurs being made into a building, real dinosaurs. Before we get to that, let's talk about something else first. Dinosaurs on buildings. Apparently, at Princeton University in Princeton, New Jersey, there are several gargoyles which exist, some of which are modeled after dinosaurs or other extinct creatures. We have a trilobite right here. We've got various pterosaurs. This one looks like Dimorphodon right there. That may or may not be a Smilodon. It's hard to tell. This is either an elephant or a mastodon. What's more mastodon-y to me? And a ceratopsian dinosaur. Very, very cool. Yeah. Pretty neat. And not like the catacombs in France, but something else. Catangel Arts. Yeah. Something else. Yeah. Dozens of gargoyles of animals, living and extinct, decorate the exterior of Guyot Hall. Here are some of the more picturesque ones. The limestone carvings were reportedly created in the studio of Gutzon Borglum, sculptor of Mount Rushmore, which we were talking about earlier. All these callbacks here. It's almost like I planned it that way. Pretty cool. And there's a super special one, which is not featured there, but exists here. Who can tell me what sort of creature this is? Anybody in chat familiar with this beastie here? Not a sphinx, not a panda. Nope. Not a rhino, but you're getting a little bit closer. A little bit closer. Not a camel. Not a hippo or a warthog, but a brontothere, Dr. Irrefutable, or a uintotherium. I don't actually know which of those is the proper term nowadays. But yeah. Uintotherium. This lovely critter from the Uinta Mountains of Utah and Wyoming. It is a pretty cool critter. I live streamed these a couple times, actually, when we were at the Vernal Fieldhouse Museum in Vernal, Utah. Yeah. So, brontotheres or uintotheres, they're, They're a group of Eocene mammals. They're extinct, completely gone. They're not rhinoceros. They're not horses. They're not warthogs. They're not anything else. Trying to find you a decent video on these critters. Yeah. Brontotheres, I think, are basically the... Are they the same creatures, or are they not? Brontotheres. Here's Russell Hawley to talk about them, but I gotta make sure this is the same kind of critter first. You went to Therium. There we go. Not a lot of info here. Shoot. So Brontotheres are different. Shoot. Yeah. You went to Therium has been found, shoot, in four different states. I didn't realize that. California and Texas, along with, of course, Utah and Wyoming. Huh. Yeah. Well. I guess Brontotheres are later. You went to Therium. Also known as Dinosaurids. I think that's what Cope called them, and Marsh called them Brontotheres, or Uintotheres. Anyway, I'm trying to find you a decent video on these, and there's not really any... anywhere. Huh. That is wild. I'm looking for something decent here about the science of these animals, and there's not much. Well, here is, that's funny, Fisher actually showed me this over the summer when we were in the quarry digging up dinosaurs. Here is a Japanese commercial featuring Uintotherium. Take a look. What? So you went to Therium lived like 50 million years ago. The first humans evolved like less than a million years ago. So that was something. I agree, Anakin Gabriel, yes. Wreaking his prehistoric fury on modern man and his puny machines. And Rogan, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Oh, and Brother Moody, I didn't say hello to you yet with your, is that a chipmunk emote? I like it. Or some kind of squirrel, some kind of rodent. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It's great to have you here. Yeah. Mr. Sparkle? Bimcat, yeah. Anyway, that was a Uintother. And here's...
After the extinction of the non-avian dinosaurs.
No closed captions on this, sorry.
Pretty quickly. Within a few million years of the KPG mass extinction, mammals, birds, and reptiles took on many of the niches left open by the fall of the Saurians. This resulted in many huge and bizarre forms. One of the first mammal groups to get big resembled...
You're good, Golganak. I don't even remember what you're talking about.
...quite a ways removed from them genetically. These were the Dinosauridans, and some of the first ideas on how they looked and lived are totally far out.
Hmm.
As much as I talk about the Bone Wars, Edie Cope, O.C. Marsh, and their contributions to dinosaur science, the whole period, and everyone working during it, were also instrumental to the understanding of biodiversity. Between the end of the Mesozoic...
Oh, I did a live stream from here. This is the Museum of Natural History in Denver, Colorado. The Denver Museum of Science and Nature, I believe it's called. Yeah. Anyway, you went to Thiers, and this is another... museum that I did a live stream from back here. Lighty.
The Dinoceratids show a lot of characteristics.
It's the Vernal Fieldhouse Museum.
But the group came so early on in mammal evolution and have such a mishmash of characters.
You remember that stream? It was a good one, right?
Don't really comfortably fit into the ungulate clade as it's.
So yeah, so these are not true like hoofed mammals. Anyway, I'll give you a link to this video if you want to watch the rest of it. We don't really have time or place for that here, but yeah, the reason I bring this up is because of this. There we go. This is one of the gargoyles that you could see at Princeton, apparently. Pretty neat. Yeah. Anyway, good stuff. A gargoyle of a Uintatheer. That is actually pretty neat. That's actually pretty neat. I like it a lot. So yeah, fossil creatures and architecture. This is how we're making those connections. Since the 80 when I grew up? Dan the BC Man. Which dinosaur are you talking about? It's a case-by-case thing. If you have a specific example, I can address that. And you like the trilobite one too, Golganek? Isn't that cool? Right there. Pretty neat. At the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C., there are various gargoyles, including here we go, check this out.
Me enjoying the view of DC from the top of the National Cathedral. Here's why. The cathedral has some great hidden treasures if you like hunting for Easter eggs, but these surprises are a little grotesque.
All gargoyles are grotesque, but not all grotesques are gargoyles. A grotesque.
Interesting. Again, we're talking about architecture on today's stream, and we're talking about how we can use that to talk about fossil science. Let's talk about gargoyles for a little bit.
Is a carving, an animal, a humanoid, a crazy, devilish-looking thing. Only function is decorative. A gargoyle is a grotesque that has a water pipe in its mouth, and they're part of the rain gutter system. Historically, like, talking like medieval times, it was a way that the church adopted popular culture. It was a belief in evil spirits, and so they put these gargoyles, these scary-looking creatures, on the building to repel the evil spirits.
Adopting the pop culture, that means Darth Vader actually makes a lot of sense.
Exactly.
Darth Vader is Kevin's favorite grotesque. To spot him, look at the north side, but he's hard to see unless you're on the east face balcony.
The north side of the cathedral, or the dark side of the cathedral.
You can get your own in the gift shop. Other fun decor on the building includes a horse skeleton, a rat.
So we didn't actually get to see that. The Darth Vader gargoyle. There we go. There it is right there. This is on the National Cathedral. I don't know why the U.S. has a National Cathedral. It almost seems like it might be in violation of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. The Establishment Clause. Separation of church and state, but whatever. It's Darth Vader. Gargoyle. That's cool. Yeah, and there's also an alien from the film Alien. Look at that. I think these are made in the 80s. Alien, I think that film, Ridley Scott's Alien came out in what, 1979? Star Wars was 1977. These are both cultural phenomena. Yeah. The Darth Vader grotesque is a limestone grotesque by J. Hall Carpenter. Though sometimes seen as a graffito or form of vandalism on the church, due to the pop culture subject matter contrasted with the holy building. Oh, please. Get over yourself. It is a deliberate approved addition. Yeah. It's one of the many grotesques that are part of the National Cathedral's rain control system. The grotesque deflect rainwater by bouncing it off the tops of their heads and away from the stone walls. Very cool. Yeah, in the 1980s, during the construction of the Northwest Tower, a children's competition was run by National Geographic World to draw grotesques for the building. Christopher Rader won third place with his drawing of Star Wars villain Darth Vader. The head was sculpted by J. Hall Carpenter, and the stone carver was Patrick J. Plunkett. It's difficult to see with the naked eye, and binoculars are generally needed to spot it. Other winning designs were a raccoon, a girl with pigtails and braces, both very scary, and a man with large teeth and an umbrella, perhaps the scariest of all. A man with large teeth and an umbrella? It's the stuff of nightmares there. And the National Cathedral is a private one. It's not government owned. I did not know that, Kennedy. Interesting. Anyway.
Dog, Cerberus, and Medusa.
My favorite gargoyle, if I had to choose one, it's Medusa.
There's also this rejected gargoyle that can't go on the side of the building.
The way he was carved, this could have potentially held water and would not have shed the water properly.
Ooh.
They rejected it.
Joe and his crew are repairing the damage caused by the 2011 earthquake, which is why the scaffolding was there for me to climb. It is not open to the general public. You can spot some of the carvings walking around the grounds, but if you want to get really up close and personal with the high up ones like Darth Vader, you can sign up for the Angels and Monsters Tower Climb.
Interesting. Anyway, gargoyles are interesting things, especially when they are modeled after extinct organisms like trilobites, Uintatheres, pterosaurs, or ceratopsian dinosaurs. You know? Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. Good stuff. You may or may not realize that there is also a dinosaur named Gargoyleosaurus. It looks like this. It's an ankylosaur. There's a really lovely render. I like that one a lot. Gargoyleosaurus. This is an early ankylosaur from the Jurassic of North America, the Morrison Formation. And it was so named because I guess the authors thought it looked kind of gargoyly. Yeah. We do love our ankylosaurs. I agree, Claire Burr. Yeah. They are very cool critters. This is not a very big one. The first ankylosaurs are pretty small. So it's not a huge animal. The biggest ankylosaurs would be in the late Cretaceous. But what a cool animal. Gargoyleosaurus. And I asked Jim Kirkland about this over the summer. I said, do you pronounce it Gargoyleosaurus or Gargoyleosaurus? And Jim said, I usually say Gargoyleosaurus, I believe. And, yeah. It's a neat animal. It was described by Ken Carpenter and others in 1998. Who was the... Let's find that reference. Carpenter, Miles, and Cloward. Okay. Yeah. It's a cool critter, Gargoyleosaurus. You could also call it Gargoyleosaurus. I'm sure nobody would be mad at you for that. But yeah, a neat animal. Pretty cool. I always thought Gorgonopsians would make really good gargoyles on like a museum or a cathedral or something like that. Maybe someday we'll have an opportunity to do that. But in fact, maybe I should talk to somebody about that. But yeah, yeah. Those are fossil organisms as gargoyles, and now we're talking about architecture and how sometimes fossil science finds its way into that. So now the thing de resistance. We've talked about buildings being built to look like dinosaurs. We've talked about dinosaurs incorporated into the facades of buildings, like those gargoyles that are both of dinosaurs and other extinct creatures. But now let's talk about times when dinosaurs have literally been made into buildings. Where's that book? Here it is. The famous story of the bone cabin. This is one that goes way back in the kind of like original, well, original mythology. Anyway, it's a well-known story. Right here. A house made of bones. This is from, well, it appears in such venues as the Big Golden Book of Dinosaurs, lots and lots of other books as well. But this is a true story. It probably didn't look quite like this. But yeah. Scientists used dinosaur bones to figure out what these ancient creatures looked like and how they lived. Jaw bones to tell how a dinosaur chewed or didn't chew in most cases. And what it ate. Large rough places on bones show where strong muscles attached. But the strangest of all uses for dinosaur bones surprised some fossil hunters in Wyoming. One day they found a small building that looked rather like a log cabin. A sheep herder had built it for himself, but not from logs. He made it from huge dinosaur bones. Just beyond Bone Cabin, the fossil hunters discovered more enormous bones. Dinosaurs had lived and died there millions of years before. One of these was the great Camarasaurus. Camarasaurus, whom you see right here, being menaced by the vicious Allosaurus. And we've got both of these dinosaurs here. In the office, of course, there's Camarasaurus right there and Allosaurus right here. Yeah. Anyway, most likely the bones of both of those dinosaurs went into the original bone cabin. There are no photographs that exist of the bone cabin. Not the original one, anyway. So you'll see artistic renderings of this, and sometimes they're a little bit... sometimes they're a little bit fanciful. I'll show you. There we go. This is a book I've had since I was a child. Would a dinosaur eat my teacher? This is actually a really fun book, and it was written by a paleontologist. I got this book from a wrapping paper fundraiser sale thing. So it's one of these like free books that you get, but it's actually really well written. Apart, you know, this has got goofy artwork and everything, but there's legit science in here. It's written by a legit paleontologist, Carl Mailing. And where is our... bone cabin here. There we go. Did people build houses out of giant dinosaur bones? And I feel like the addition of the word giant here is meant to distinguish avian from non-avian dinosaurs. But yeah, at least one person built a house out of the bones of giant dinosaurs. In the late 1800s, a shepherd in Como Bluff, Wyoming, used a 145-million-year-old dinosaur bone from the Morrison Formation, late Jurassic, to build his home. When fossil hunters learned of this unique house, they searched the area, now called Bone Cabin Quarry, and found skeletons of Apatosaurus and other giant dinosaurs. So yeah, fanciful illustration here. But, the story is a true one. And there is a more modern Bone Cabin, kind of inspired by the original. The original, I'm sure, fell down long, long ago. Probably around the time that the railroads were really taking off in Wyoming. But yeah, it looked just like a Flintstones house. Yeah, there's probably not, but yeah. You can go see it today in Wyoming.
Medicine Bow, Wyoming. If you blink, you might miss it driving along Highway 30.
We're a tight-knit community.
An old train depot sits in the middle of town.
The trains will be a problem.
Turned into a history museum.
This museum is awesome.
But a new addition is about to unearth.
Ah.
A cabin made...
The Fossil Cabin Museum. So this is not the original Bone Cabin? But it's kind of a similar idea.
Completely out of dinosaur bones.
Getting that fossil cabin, that is going to be so wonderful. Historically, because it'll help preserve it.
It's been closed for 20 years. The town doesn't want it to go extinct.
I love that place. You know, I take my kid there once a week. At least.
The roadside attraction once home to dinosaur bones, now those are gone.
Vandals have started just... breaking in, stealing all of the bones, just breaking windows to be breaking them.
With help from the community and sponsors, they dug up over $42,000 to move it.
I think it's going to be great. Raising the money and doing this is what's got me nervous.
Which will do more than preserve it.
Now, you've heard of roadside attractions like the biggest ball of yarn, or maybe the largest wicker basket, or maybe even a dinosaur museum. Now, these have a special history here.
Or maybe even a dinosaur museum? I'm sorry, the world's biggest ball of yarn or a giant wicker basket are stranger than a dinosaur museum. I was at a museum this morning that houses dinosaur fossils. I did not visit the world's largest ball of yarn or a giant wicker basket. Those are the weird ones. Sorry, I'm nitpicking
maybe
again.
Maybe even a dinosaur museum. Now, these have a special history here in the United States of getting people to stop in small towns.
I have four boys that love dinosaur bones, and this is something that they would love to see and just come out and look around and try and guess what the different bones were.
And making it worth a stop to fossilize a memory of your own while driving by.
One, two, three, dinosaur!
Dinosaur!
Elizabeth Van Mitri, News 13, Medicine Bow.
Yeah, so I bet you there's a Wikipedia article for the Bone Cabin, or even Bone... Well, if not that, then at least Bone Cabin Quarry. Let's take a look. Bone Cabin Quarry. It's a dinosaur quarry that lays approximately 55 miles northwest of Laramie, Wyoming, near historic Como Bluff. During the summer of 1897, Walter Granger, who was used to be chief paleontologist for the, or chief field paleontologist for like the American Museum of Natural History's expeditions to Mongolia, he came upon a hillside littered with Jurassic period dinosaur bone fragments. Nearby was a sheep herder cabin built entirely out of fossil bones, hence the name Bone Cabin Quarry. Well, well, well. Look at that clipping there. Bone Cabin Quarry. A treasure house of fossils discovered by accident. A few years ago, some men who were crossing the Badlands of Wyoming... And you know what? Actually, this old-timey article deserves a different soundtrack, doesn't it? A Bone Cabin Quarry. A treasure house of fossils discovered by accident. From Appleton's Magazine. A few years ago, some men who were crossing the Badlands of Wyoming chanced upon a little hut once the home of a sheep herder, but long since abandoned. One of the party noticed that the house did not rest directly upon the ground, but upon piles of what seemed to be dark-colored stones. In this part of the Badlands, one seldom sees even a pebble, and the stones aroused his interest. Pulling one out, which had become loosened, he gave an exclamation of surprise. It was a fragment of a brontosaurus, the greatest creature known to man. Bone Cabin Quarry, as the place is now known to scientists the world over, is by far the greatest hunting ground for these animals of the past that has yet been discovered. Since it was first visited on that spring day in the year 1808, the Badlands have been a gathering place for fossil hunters from both the old and the new world. The locality forms a vast graveyard of the monster lizards, known as dinosaurs, as well as strange horses that lived in the old days. Horses, what? Is it talking about like Eocene horses? Crocodiles older than any that have ever floated in the Nile, and mammoth turtles. The way in which these hunters of extinct animals and reptiles, find their mighty game is interesting. In searching for it, they bring their aid geology and in natural history. Their weapons are chiefly the pick, shovel, and spade, but some of the places containing the skeletons are so large that they have to use plows and scrapers drawn by horses to remove the earth covering. Bone Cabin Quarry itself is a revelation. As the cabin was torn down and the richness of the find revealed, the ground was divided into spaces 12 feet square, and one after another was opened. It has taken 6 years working with the plow and shovel and spade to turn up about 7,500 square feet, less than one-fifth of an acre of surface. Yet this small space formed the resting place of parts of 73 different animals, of whom 44 belong to the family of dinosaurs. Anyway, cool stuff. Here's a link right here, if you'd like to take a look at that yourself. Bone Cabin Quarry. An interesting place. You still hear about Bone Cabin Quarry to this very day. I think it might be private land now. But our dinosaur Gargoyleosaurus, whom we were talking about, is also known from the Bone Cabin Quarry West locality there. There you go. Cool stuff. Very cool stuff. There's a photo of this locality from 1898. So yeah. Overburdened as heck in any age, I suppose. Agreed, Golganek, agreed. Yeah. Glass plate photo? I think you're right, Jody Fish. I think you are correct about that. Yeah. And tactile 3D picture has got a dinosaur deep diver quest on pterosaurs, I guess? Tactile says pterodactyl. How are these related to chickens? They're not. My niece asked. She says it's a great show and she enjoys it. Her name is Cassie. Well, hello, hello, Cassie. How are you doing? I'm glad you're enjoying this, and let's talk about pterosaurs a little bit, shall we? So pterosaurs, which some people call pterodactyls, paleontologists, we call them pterosaurs, though. That's kind of the proper name for them. It's pterosaurs. Pterosaurs, these animals are like close cousins of the dinosaurs. They're not dinosaurs themselves, but they're like close relatives of the dinosaurs. Here is a little video about these critters. Let's talk about them.
Much like today's birds, pterosaurs ruled Earth's Mesozoic skies.
Yep. So pterosaurs lived at the same time as the dinosaurs, but they're not quite dinosaurs themselves. Yeah. And dactyl just means finger, so calling the group that doesn't really make sense. Well, I mean, it does. Pterodactyl means wing finger, and that actually makes a lot of sense when you understand how their wing is constructed. What you're seeing right here on the screen, this is just the ring finger of this animal. This is digit number 4, the ring finger, right here. You know, Cassie, if you're watching right now, your ring finger... Imagine if your ring finger, this one finger, was 4 times as long as your whole body on each hand. Be pretty crazy, right? That's how it is for pterosaurs.
Into many different habitats while their dinosaur cousins roamed below.
Yep.
But these were no birds.
Not birds. Yeah. So how are they related to birds, including chickens? Let's talk about that for a second, then we'll get back to the video. So here is a nifty little chart. Everything from this point on is a dinosaur. This is what we call a family tree right here. Dinosaurs are right here. Pterosaurs are right next to them. But since dinosaurs start here and pterosaurs aren't up here, pterosaurs are not dinosaurs. But they're very, very close to dinosaurs. A pterosaur is almost as close as you can be to being a dinosaur, while not quite being a dinosaur. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Those were flying reptiles, and some were as big as fighter jets.
They were big. Yeah.
Pterosaurs means winged lizard in Greek, and they were the very first vertebrates on Earth to take to the skies.
Mm-hmm.
The most well-known pterosaur is the pterodactyl.
So, I guess you could say pterodactyl. This is genus Pterodactylus, which is where the term pterodactyl comes from. But that name means wing finger. Ptero means wing. Dactyl means finger, because the wing is constructed of that fourth finger right there.
It was the first one discovered back in the 18th century. But since then, paleontologists have uncovered more than 200 different species.
Oh yeah, there's a lot.
Which were quite large, and Quetzalcoatlus, one of the most massive pterosaurs of all.
Yeah.
Named for the Aztec winged serpent god, Quetzalcoatlus had a wingspan of nearly 40 feet and likely soared through the skies hunting for baby dinosaurs below.
Pretty cool animal. Quetzalcoatlus itself was huge. I did a live stream a couple of live streams in 2021 where I saw some Quetzalcoatlus models and posed in front of them. I really need to email that hard drive to Claire so she can get those videos uploaded to YouTube and I can reference them. But Quetzalcoatlus is one of the very biggest of the pterosaurs. It was enormous. Look at how big this pterosaur is. So here is a human man. There is Quetzalcoatlus. Huge, right? Huge. Yeah. Pretty incredible creature. These guys probably would have been pretty scary. Here, check this out. There's T-Rex there.
America's top predator.
But wait for the Quetzalcoatlus to show up.
6-inch long teeth. Tearing through an Alamosaur's tough skin is not a problem.
Yeah.
T-Rex might be able to bully troodontids, but a carcass as big as this soon attracts more formidable competition.
What could challenge a T-Rex? How about Quetzalcoatlus?
Quetzalcoatlus, a giant pterosaur.
Yeah.
One of the few creatures that will challenge an adult tyrannosaur.
That's plausible, I think. I mean, maybe. Those long, thin legs on the Quetzalcoatlus as it walks.
One strike from its 6-foot-long beak could easily cost T-Rex an eye.
It's only got two of those. You don't want to lose one.
Even so, it seems that he's not going to back down.
Uh-oh.
But the arrival of a second Quetzalcoatlus changes the odds.
Wow, and if you want to see how this shakes out, well, I'll give you the link right here. And, you can watch that on your own time. But yeah, pretty cool critter, Quetzalcoatlus.
And likely soared through the skies hunting for baby dinosaurs below. Some, yeah. Like Enuragnathus, were the size of small birds.
And we were just talking about this critter yesterday, little Enuragnathus. There we go. Nope. Anura means frog, I guess. Or it's a genus of frog, but Enuragnathus. It was this critter. Remember this guy from yesterday, everybody? Yeah, some pterosaurs were very small and probably pretty cute. Yeah. So a lot of diversity in pterosaurs in terms of body size, in terms of morphology. They were neat critters. They were very neat critters.
And probably preferred to eat insects. With such a wide range in pterosaur size, there is ongoing debate over how some species were...
Oh, and Joanna says, dinosaur with pug face. It's not a dinosaur. I want to emphasize that very heavily here. None of these are dinosaurs. These are pterosaurs. They're like cousins to the dinosaurs. But they're not dinosaurs themselves. Yeah. Yeah, no worries. But yeah. Yeah.
Able to fly. But similarities in their wing structure and anatomy may offer clues. Pterosaur wings ran along their sides from shoulder to ankle, and each wing was held up and supported by an elongated digit.
That's just the ring finger right there. That's just digit number 4. Your ring finger right there forms all of that. This is the hand right here. See those little fingers? Right here? That's the ring finger. Crazy. All the other fingers are super short. The ring finger is just crazy long. Yeah.
The first pterosaur ever discovered was actually named for this characteristic.
Yep.
Pterodactyl is a combination of the Greek words for wing and finger.
You
Each
bet.
Pterosaur yep. wing consisted of a tough membrane laced with blood vessels, fibrous cords, and muscles. And it has been theorized that the muscles could alter the shape of their wings in mid-flight, the same way a passenger jet might adjust its wings during takeoff and landing.
Pretty cool.
Pterosaur fossils also suggest that even the largest species must have been relatively light for their size, because,
very light.
Like birds, their bones were hollow.
Very, very hollow. In fact, you might even say... that,
A dirter.
Yeah, you might even say that they are... Well, let me find that real quick. Let's find this bit, shall we? How thin are those bones?
Their hind legs
paleontologist Kevin Padian demonstrates.
This is not the clip that we're looking for. We're looking for another one, which is right here. How thin are those bones? Kevin Padian is I was literally just here today, this morning, in this museum, in the collections. The evolution of flight and the anatomy. I was right over there. Pterosaurs. Yeah.
The first thing to know about pterosaur bones is that they have the thinnest bones of any vertebrates. This one squashed completely flat, flat as a pancake. And it's, you know, like it was just like it was run over by an 18-wheeler sometime in the Cretaceous.
Dave Dog says there might be marrow in those bones, right? No. Uh-oh. It just, well, maybe a tiny, tiny little bit, but these are hollow bones. Extremely thin.
And it's, you know, like it was just like it was run over by an 18-wheeler sometime in the Cretaceous there in the middle of the ocean, right? And it's a very, this bone comes from the upper arm, like this.
It's a humerus.
It's squashed completely flat.
Within minutes, they were finding fossils.
And Dave Daga, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontology.
The bone wall is so thin, it's about the same dimension as the wall of a dirder. A dirder is one of those things you get at the end of the paper towels, the cardboard thing in the middle, you go dirt, dirt, dirt. Well, that's what this thing is like.
Yep.
Except there's nothing in the middle of it. I mean, it's just completely air-filled and
no marrow.
Squashed flat, and the bone walls are very, very thin. Now, you might think this would make it a very weak bone, but in fact, we checked this out with some engineers at Stanford, and we're working with them, and they showed us that, in fact, the big diameter of this arm is what really makes it strong.
Despite its hollow center, the thickness of the walls of the pterosaur bones enabled them to withstand the forces of flight. Calculations show that pterosaur bones are up to 86% stronger than similar mammal bones.
Pretty cool. Pretty cool.
Hollow bones would have enabled even Quetzalcoatlus to soar. But not all pterosaurs could fly. In 2009,
wait, what?
Paleontologists found,
I think this has been disputed,
in Transylvania that they nicknamed Dracula. At 11 and a half feet tall, with a wingspan of 39 feet, it's one of the largest pterosaurs ever found. But the shape of its shoulders and wings suggests it probably couldn't get off the ground.
I think this has been disputed since then. I think we now think that this critter could also fly. This is Hatsugopteryx, isn't it? Or is it a different one? I'm not sure. I'm not a pterosaur expert.
With every new discovery, paleontologists are learning more about the nature of pterosaurs. But the hollow bones that enabled some of the largest pterosaurs to fly are also part of the reason their fossils are so often incomplete.
Oh, yeah.
And the full picture of a sky once ruled by reptiles has yet to be revealed.
Cool stuff. So pterosaurs, they're like cousins to the dinosaurs. They're not dinosaurs themselves, and thus, they're not related to birds. Birds, however, are dinosaurs. So going back to our family tree image before, remember we have dinosaurs right here. Pterosaurs are there. So they're very close cousins of the dinosaurs, but they're not dinosaurs themselves. However, you scroll up, and what's this up here? That's a bird. And this is coming off of the theropod branch of the dinosaur family tree. Birds are dinosaurs. So a pterosaur or pterodactyl, not a dinosaur. But the next time you look out your window and you see a chickadee or a sparrow or a crow or a gull or a pigeon or whatever, any kind of bird, that's a dinosaur that you're looking at. Which is pretty cool. So, yeah, Cassie, if you're still watching, I hope that makes sense. I hope you learned something. Yeah. Good question. Thanks for asking. And are there reptiles on that diagram? Where would they go? So yeah, almost every creature on this diagram is a reptile. The dinosaurs, the birds, the pterosaurs, the crocodiles, the turtles. This is your only non-reptile branch. So mammals are not reptiles. But everything else on here is a reptile. Yeah. Does that make sense? So reptiles start right here. So everything that comes off of this node is a reptile, including dinosaurs, pterosaurs, and birds. Tactile says she said thank you. Well, great. Cassie, thanks for being so polite. Thanks for your good question. Anyway, good stuff. And they even started... Well, no, Claire, that's not totally true. So, mammals did not start as reptiles. That's a common misperception. One that was even actually spread by programs like Urine or Fish. So... Mammals never were reptiles. The split between reptiles and mammals happens at the very origin of these groups. So when amniotes first started laying eggs on land, you know, the split happens right there. So reptiles split off, mammals split off. Mammals never were a kind of reptile. Yeah. So that term mammal-like reptile that we use to, that some people use to describe creatures like Dimetrodon right here, that's wrong. They're not reptiles at all. If you use the term reptile-like mammal instead of mammal-like reptile, it would be much more correct. Yeah. In fact, I even have a TikTok about this from last Halloween, or two Halloweens ago.
Ready to carve up this pumpkin? I thought everybody's gonna be expecting me to do a dinosaur. So I'm gonna buck expectations a little bit and do something that is distinctly not a dinosaur and make it be about not being a dinosaur.
Yep.
Tell me what that is. Dimetrodon, there you go. Yeah, Dimetrodon. This critter is more closely related to you and me than it is to any dinosaur, which is pretty cool to think about. These are very, very charismatic animals. You see them in all kinds of assorted plastic dinosaurs, boxes and stuff. But they're not dinosaurs. These predate the dinosaurs by, probably a solid 60 million years.
So those guys evolved long before the dinosaurs.
Started with pumpkin carving. First thing that I've got to do for this is carve out the top. Unfortunately, I don't have any anesthetic for our pumpkin friend here. It's time for your lobotomy. There we go. Look at that. Pulling out all the guts right here.
This is a lot of fun. I wonder if I'll carve a pumpkin this year. I should, probably. That'd be fun to do on stream.
You see it in a movie or
put that on the calendar.
Like you can say, hey, that's not a dinosaur. That's a Dimetrodon. Check it out.
Or something again? What'd you learn, Golganek? What'd you learn?
Very nice. Very nice. Our not a dinosaur.
Iconic Song says that drawing is nice. Wait till you see it illuminated like a jack-o'-lantern.
Dimetrodon. Let me turn off all the lights. yes. Check that out. Oh, man. That is pretty cool. I like that a lot. I'm pretty happy with this.
That was fun. That was a lot of fun. Maybe I'll do another not a dinosaur pumpkin this year. I did an Elasmosaur a while back. I don't know if I ever actually... Yeah, we did that live on stream. That was fun. Maybe I'll do another one. Oh, the earlier split of reptiles. Yeah, that's actually something that I learned just a couple years ago, Golganek. I didn't realize that either. It's often mistaught. Yeah. Spacing Guild says carving a pumpkin always seems like it's going to be easier than it actually is. Well, when you have the spice for it, Spacing Guild, then you can fold the pumpkin in your mind and envision what it'll look like. Welcome, Spacing Guild. It's good to see you. But yeah, yeah. And Brickmaster E, you did find the original. Yeah. This you can actually buy on the, I think, 250 MYA page. There it is. If you'd like to buy that poster and support that artist. There you go. Yeah. The pumpkin spice must flow. There you go, Spacing Guild. Yeah. yeah. Pumpkin is one of the earliest domesticated plants. Is that true, Espy? Pumpkin's a New World plant, though. Are you sure about that? I wonder. Because human beings didn't even get to North America until, what, like 14,000 years ago? Maybe one of is doing a lot of work in that sentence. Maybe it's one of the first 100 or something like that. I don't know. But yeah. Yeah. Anywho. Should we put pumpkin carving on our calendar for October? What if we did that here? A pumpkin carving stream. Maybe we'll do that on the 30th. Pumpkin carving stream. And let's take that. And take that. This will be on Monday the 30th. And what do we do for like a ghost emoji? Yeah. Cool. That'll be great. And yeah, I should print a terror bird skull for our Terror Bird stream on the 26th. That'll be Thursday, Bird's Day. Again, I will be not streaming on a couple of my normal streaming days because I'm going to be traveling to TwitchCon for these. And I should actually put that on here. No stream, but hosting scientists on stream panel discussion at TwitchCon, and I'll put a link on there too. And let's make this one a slightly different color. Can't even see that there. But there we go. And I'll put the link in there. Yeah. There is that link. Let me get a link shortener there. Free URL shortener. Shorten URL. Copy. Excellent. Good stuff. Yeah. Clipper says, will you not be going live with your field rig at all? Not at TwitchCon, no, because I need to use satellite internet for that, and that's not really going to work inside of a building. And even if it were outdoors, it's like, I don't want anybody running away with my satellite rig, you know? Yeah. So yeah. Yeah. And Brickmaster ECS, I love Terror Birds. Well, tune in on the 26th. We're going to be talking all about them for Thursday Birds Day on Thursday, October 26th. Yeah. So anyway, and Lordy says, don't buy your pumpkin too late or the person at the store might tease you about it. I might buy it tomorrow morning. We'll see. We'll see. They've all probably been picked at this point anyway, so might as well buy it early. Yeah. And Oh, that's interesting, Espy. How ancient humans helped bring pumpkins to your Thanksgiving table? I'm sure we'll talk about this. This is great. Thank you, Espy. Very nice. Very, very nice. They've long been essential staples in human diet and culture. Very cool. Well, exciting things coming up, everybody. Exciting things coming up. And with that having been said, I've got some stuff I gotta take care of this evening. And so it is about time for me to wrap up this broadcast here. There's a Smilodon skull, a Smilodon which is a mammal, to run our credits over. Let's see who else is here on Twitch doing some science, perhaps. We can raid into them. Let's see here. Searching. You know what? Creatrix Brit is streaming. Let's go say hello to her. She's doing some 3D printing and Star Wars cosplay creation. That'll be cool. Anyway, thank you everybody for making this a fun stream. Thank you for your support. Thank you for your follows. Thank you for your raids. Thank you for your moderation, moderators. Appreciate you. I've got to take care of some stuff, and I got to go get some exercise tonight, too. So, I hope to see you tomorrow, where we'll be discussing dinosaurs of Lesotho for Lesotho's National Day. We'll be talking about Sputnik on the anniversary of Sputnik and how it changed science policy here in the United States, how that echoes into the present day. So I hope you'll be here for that. It's going to be a lot of fun. Until then, everybody, you take care of yourselves, and I'll catch you later. Bye-bye.